Invicta FC makes its return to the Oklahoma City area tonight, and the Atomweight Championship of the World is on the line in our main event. Defending champ Jéssica the Queen Delboni holds her first title defense as she takes on Invicta veteran Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey, who gets her first shot at the belt. The tenacious Delboni made the most of her rematch with Alicia Zapatella to earn the 105-pound belt at Invicta FC 45. Now she puts it on the line against Jillian DeCoursey, who earned this title shot with a devastating first-round knockout of Lindsey VanZandt at IFC 47. In tonight's co-main event, we've got a mouth-watering flyweight matchup as Maiju Mountain Mama Suotama faces Kelton Escandinha Souza. These fights and many more are headed your way next from Sugar Creek Casino in Hinton, Oklahoma. This is Invicta FC 49, Delboni versus DeCoursey.
The anticipation is building at Sugar Creek Casino in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, as we get set for Invicta FC 49, Delboni versus DeCoursey. The Atomweight Championship of the World is on the line tonight in one of seven mouth-watering fights that we've got on tap for you tonight. Welcome in, everybody. I'm Nate Bucati, and it is indeed a pleasure to be here at Sugar Creek Casino in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. And we got a great night of fights on tap for you. And let's bring in Invicta FC legend, Jules Kedzie. We're excited about this one, Jules, and a great Atomweight Championship on the line tonight.
Oh, my, yes. We are back in Oklahoma for the first time since 2018 with a main event between two fan favorites in one of my favorite weight classes, the Atomweight division. Jéssica Delboni will be defending her title for the first time against Jillian the Lionheart DeCoursey.
And that's one of seven fantastic fights that we've got ready for you tonight. And for more on that, let's check in with the third member of our crew, another legend, Megan Anderson. And Megan, with all these great fights outside of the main event, which one stands out to you the most?
I mean, we have a lot of debuts on tonight's card. There's a lot to prove for a lot of these ladies. But if I have to pick one fight, I'm actually going to pick two. I'm going to go with Invicta staple Helen Peralta taking on UFC alum Poliana Botelho, and Valesca Machado taking on Liz the Titan Tracy. All four of them incredible athletes, and there is a lot on the line for both of these fights, a lot of implications for the winner.
All right, so let's get to the main event, Delboni versus DeCoursey for the Atomweight Championship of the World. And Julie, Jéssica the Queen Delboni is the latest in a long line of great champs in this division at Invicta FC.
That's true, Nate. Within its 10-year history, the battle for the Invicta Atomweight title has produced some of the brightest stars in MMA. And Jéssica the Queen Delboni is the seventh woman to be crowned its champion. It was right here in Oklahoma that she began her Invicta career, and her crisp striking and technical prowess earned her a title shot against Alicia Zapatella in May of 2021. She lost the first outing by a split decision, but this past January, Jéssica Delboni avenged her loss to Alicia Zapatella, and the queen was able to claim her crown. But a championship belt also represents a bullseye, and tonight she faces her first test in Jillian the Lionheart DeCoursey.
And Megan, Jillian DeCoursey has really earned this title shot.
She really has, Nate, and everything seems to have come full circle tonight for the challenger, Jillian DeCoursey, who made her professional debut here inside the Invicta cage back in 2017. After coming up through the Atomweight ranking, she's finally challenging for the title for the first time 5 years later. Never want to let a big opportunity go to waste, though. She's ready to shock the world for a second time after she earned her shot at the title by knocking out Lindsey VanZandt in the first round back at Invicta FC 47 earlier this year. She's ready to show that lightning can strike twice in her pursuit for the Atomweight Championship.
Jéssica the Queen Delboni versus Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey. That is our main event tonight in the Atomweight Championship bout. For more on that and the rest of tonight's card, let's go into the cage and the fourth member of our crew, Allie Trost Martin.
Thanks, Nate. A thrilling main event matchup ahead with Jéssica Delboni telling us that she feels relaxed, prepared, and confident ahead of her title defense, while her opponent, Jillian DeCoursey, is looking to tap into that underdog mentality in order to win the belt and prove to people that she's so much more than just a wrestler and a grappler. But in addition to that fight, we have six other must-watch fights on tonight's card. So let's get into them, starting with the co-main event. This fight features Maiju Mountain Mama Suotama, who stepped in on just 2 weeks' notice, and Ketlen Souza in her Invicta debut. Before that, Liz Tracy and Valesca Machado face off, with Tracy coming off the hardest camp of her life after missing weight in her last two fights. Then tough veterans Kaytlin Neal and Hannah Guy go head-to-head in the flyweight division. And the third fight of the night is another flyweight bout featuring Helen Peralta and Poliana Botelho, with Peralta looking to extend her Invicta record to 6-1. The second fight on tonight's card features Brittney, the Quiet Storm Cloudy, and Montserrat Rendon, with Cloudy looking for her first Invicta win over Rendon, who's making her Invicta debut. The night begins with a strawweight bout featuring Nadia Vera out of Mexico and Shauna Bannon repping Ireland, both making their Invicta debuts. Sadly, the MMA community lost one of its own. Elias Theodoro passed away on September 11th after a hard-fought battle with cancer, and as his loved ones put it, faced the end of his life just as he lived, which was irrationally and infectiously optimistic. Theodoro was also a beloved member of the Invicta FC family and served as the ring card holder, or as he liked to call himself, the ring boy. Our hearts go out to a great fighter and person who's gone way too soon.
Thank you, Ali. On behalf of everyone at Invicta FC, we dedicate tonight's telecast to the memory of Elias Theodoro, an absolute legend in the MMA community. Coming up next, we start off Invicta FC 49 with a strawweight bout. Nadia Vera out of Mexico against Shauna Bannon from Ireland. Two strawweights will collide in our first fight of the evening as Mexican Nadia Vera takes on Shauna Bannon out of Ireland. Vera had been scheduled to make her Invicta debut back in March at Invicta FC 46, but her opponent failed to make weight, so Vera had to put those plans on hold. Now, 6 months later, Vera has her shot to show what she can do.
The last time it was, unfortunately, I couldn't fight, but now it's my time. I think that I grow up more.
Vera's opponent tonight, Shauna Bannon, is also an Invicta debutante. The Ireland native has gotten her pro career off to an eye-catching start, posting a first and second round knockout at Cage Legacy 15 and 16 in Ireland. Bannon plans to showcase her power again tonight.
To get my hand raised, I need to put the pace on. She is a tough opponent, but I don't think she's ever fought anyone like me before. So when she gets hit with one of my shots, it's going to be an end game to the fight.
Coming up next, it's Nadia Vera against Shauna Bannon as Invicta FC 49 is underway.
Challenge, I accomplish anything. Right hook, yeah, I'm just throwing punches, standing tall, never ducking. I'ma always fight for something. I'm a heavy hitter. I'm a heavy hitter. Call me a conqueror. I break down every door. You're gonna hear me roar.
Draped in the flag of her homeland of Ireland, Shauna Bannon makes her way to the cage. And Jules, when we had a chance to talk to her yesterday, you talk about an effervescent, vibrant personality making her Invicta debut. She's an easy one to like right away.
Absolutely. So much charisma. And I have to say about Shauna Bannon, she is effervescent. She has a wonderful social media following. But she is also so driven, Nate. Since the birth of her son, she has put together seven straight victories, including her amateur career, and she is not going to let anything get in her way.
Megan, her last loss, she found out afterwards she was 7 weeks pregnant.
Yes.
And she hasn't lost since.
I mean, she didn't know that at the time going right to that fight. And, you know, when we spoke with her, she has kind of, she's wanting to make a home here at the strawweight division. She has been competing at higher weight classes up until this point. And when we spoke to her, she's kind of has struggled to find fights at strawweight. And one of the things that she's really looking to do here tonight is showcase her skills in a division that is really ripe with talent.
Representing Mexico, Nadia Vera, also making her Invicta FC debut here tonight. And she's had to wait for this one. She thought she was going to get a crack at her first Invicta fight back at IFC 46. Didn't work out because of her opponent missing weight. So now she gets that chance, Jules, at long last.
She does. And Nadia Vera says about that delay, you know what? Now is my time. Maybe I needed that time. I've just gone to the gym. I've trained so hard since then. Now is my time. Now is when I'm going to show Invicta what I'm made of.
Ben has been inspired, Megan, by some of the great Invicta fighters that have come out of Mexico before her.
She really has. She's taken a lot of inspiration in her career from Alexa Grasso and Irene Aldana, two incredible athletes that had amazing careers here in Invicta and have gone up to the UFC and are representing women from Mexico on the world stage. And Nadia Vera wants to inspire other women to do the same thing with her journey through the sport of MMA.
Now time for the Tale of the Tape, presented by Verdict Tournaments. Bannon versus Vera. 28 years old Bannon, 32 for Vera. And the height is strongly in favor and the reach of Shauna Bannon. Now let's send it into the cage to Joe Mar-
from Sugar Creek Casino here in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. We welcome you to an exciting night of women's professional mixed martial arts for your enjoyment. This is Invicta FC. And now, fight fans, we are set to go three rounds of action, this in the strawweight division. Introducing you first, fighting out of the blue corner. This mixed martial artist stands 5 feet, 5 inches tall, weighing in officially 115.5 pounds. In two fights, she stands perfect with two victories and no defeats. Here's the undefeated strawweight from Dublin, Ireland, Shauna Mama B. Bannon! And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist stands 5 feet, 3 inches tall. She weighed officially 115.25 pounds, and in four fights holds a record of 3 victories, no defeats, and 1 draw. Presentando la niña invicta desde Ciudad de México, México, Nadia Vera! And your referee in charge of the action is Kevin Nix.
Shauna Mama B. Bannon out of Ireland. Nadia Vera out of Mexico. Invicta FC 49 is underway from Oklahoma City. Bannon in the green, Vera in the red. and two powerful strikers going at it here to start off Invicta FC 49.
Big right hand.
Beautiful right hand by Bannon. She is finding a home early for that.
She's got a big reach advantage, Bannon, and she said she was going to put that to use early and often.
She was, but I think Nadia is doing a very good job of using that almost jumping lead leg, almost stomp to the knee of Bannon to prevent her from coming forward with that right hand. And, you know, it's going to be interesting to see how she adjusts to that range discrepancy.
Nice little right hand in there from Nadia as well, but Bannon is back on the attack.
Oh, big. Wow.
Big left kick to start that exchange from Bannon as she's got Vera up against the cage.
Bannon doing a very good job of keeping that body lock, not getting overcommitted. She's got to watch here. Beautiful transition by Vera. Oh my goodness.
Well done. You can see Bannon is reaching in with that left leg, trying to get that hook through and pull her over to the other side.
Do we have an indication as to who has the advantage once this thing goes to the ground?
I mean, I think both of them coming from heavy kickboxing and boxing backgrounds, I think this is going to be a really important chapter in this fight of who is able to be able to demonstrate their skills and dominate on the ground, because I think with two powerful strikers, it's the ground game sometimes that is the X factor.
And Nadia now in half mount.
I mean, Bannon needs to do a good job here of staying calm. She's to look for that underhook on the side that has, or with her left arm, she needs to get that underhook and look to hip out towards that side, but the cage is kind of preventing her from doing that, and Vera's doing a very good job of putting Bannon towards that side and preventing that path to escape.
You can see Bannon trying to wrap up that arm, try to prevent the ground and pound and keep Nadia's head closer to her so she can't get as much leverage. While she's working with her leg, Nadia's cognizant of that, trying not to let her pass to full guard, but Bannon gets it. Now it can be a dangerous thing to put somebody's head right up against the cage like that. Great for ground and pound if you have the positioning, but it also gives them a chance to brace and get back to their feet. That cage is a third, a third leg there at times. Bannon trying to get a better position with her hips. You can see her try to switch through there, create a platform for that arm bar.
Vera doing a good job of identifying that and just staying controlled and patient on top and seeing all of the paths that Bannon has to escape or throw up submission. She's staying calm, she's staying patient and showcasing real high level patience for somebody who has only had a couple fights.
Excuse me, nice hip switch there for Bannon. Another armbar attempt that actually can create a platform for her get up. She's trying to get to the back now, it looks like. Beautiful, beautiful hips there. Good defense by Vera, staying nice and tight. Oh, looks like the arm is in there, though. And she's out. And back in.
She's a watch out for that triangle.
Absolutely.
Oh, my goodness.
Good read. Nice hips there by Bannon. Vera knows it's there.
Beautiful.
Trying to get a good position.
Less than a minute remaining in round number one.
Oh, she's got it locked up. She's got that foot underneath that knee now. She just needs to cut that angle.
And for Vera, it's about being patient, getting back there, and getting your posture. Bannon's underhooking, not always the best thing to do in an MMA fight when you're in guard, unless you have a nice, strong position. And I would say a triangle is a pretty strong position there.
Have you guys been impressed? 30 seconds left in the round with the action of these two once they got to the ground.
I really have. I've been impressed by the striking in the stand-up. I've been very impressed by both Vera and Bannon, both offensively and defensively. I think both of them showing real high-level skills for very young in their professional careers. And the patience, man, this triangle is tight, and Vera is just doing all of the right things, staying controlled, and just showcasing her high-level skills.
And she's got a lot of confidence to be throwing knees right
100%.
There. Smart read, but you really have to make sure you're not in the choke.
So as round number one comes to a close, guys, I think we were expecting to see this be about where both were on their feet, exchanging strikes and kicks. But instead, the majority of the first round goes down to the ground.
Yeah, it really did. But, you know, both of them have extensive amateur experience. They were both IMAAF representatives of their respective countries. So they've actually, their teams have faced each other before. Bannon actually fought Nadia Vera's teammate at one point in that tournament.
Well, that let's bring in the fourth member, actually, I should say fifth member of our broadcast crew, Eve Edwards. Eve, I know you enjoy some good jiu-jitsu. What did you make of that first round?
You know, these women showed a lot of skill on the ground. I really liked what Bannon did for the bottom, fighting to get to that triangle and trying to continue and finally finish that choke. But Vera did a lot of things correct. I like both of these women taking advantage of the small mistakes the other's making, but they're also closing that gap and getting back to point zero.
And with that, round number two is underway. Megan, what adjustments are you looking to see, maybe particularly from Vera in this second round?
I would say maybe look to take it to the ground again. See how Bannon kind of is how aggressive she comes out in the first round, because she had a lot of success. I feel like more success than Vera in the first round on the stand-up. She made a mistake with the takedown. She got her position reversed and really had to work her way out of that. So I think for Vera, she just has to stay patient, stick to her game plan. But man, what a huge overhand there by Bannon.
Catching that with that right hand.
And Vera leading with that right leg low kick. Not always the smartest thing to do against a big right hand, but both of them seem unafraid of throwing big kicks.
There's another right hand from Bannon, and another.
Well, one thing that I'm not liking from Vera is she's throwing her kicks naked. Like, she's not throwing hands before, she's not setting it up, and she's not throwing hands after the kick, and she's leaving herself open and almost telegraphing that kick and essentially putting a target, because she's not bringing her head off the center line either.
Ooh.
Good combination once again from Bannon.
Yes, would very much like to see Vera let her hands go a little bit and then follow through with that kick. But it seems when she attacks, Bannon is just right on top of her with the counter. Vera doesn't seem to be slowing down.
But I mean, like, she's not setting anything up, Julie. She's just throwing it. But when she hits a, you know, 2, 3, 4 punch combination, she has success. She just needs to get going. She needs to pull the trigger. Oh, huge right hand again. That right hand just lands every single time.
Oh, it's a good counter that time, though, from Vera.
Very nice. Yeah, Vera found some range right there. Still, both of them right in the pocket in that moment. They like to hit each other.
The name of the game, Julie. Mm-hmm. Name of the game.
Right kick from Vera.
And that's kind of the second time that Vera has tried to follow through with that head duck. I would try to maybe come up off a clinch and throw a knee, but she is aiming. Oh, well, there you go. Oh, another head and arm attempt. She was able to finish it later on in the attempt last time, but they're tied up against the cage now.
Bannon doing a great job with that head control, really grinding her head up against the chin of Vera and trying to control the position, but Vera doing a good job of keeping her hips and trying to escape out the side.
Halfway through round number two.
And Vera was able to land a really big knee earlier on. I think that probably gave her a lot of hope right there about the damage she can inflict to the body. Trip attempt. Bannon showing good balance against the cage.
Vera looking to reap that outside leg. Bannon doing a really good job of staying controlled, staying balanced with her posture, not.
Yeah, Vera has that underhook there. I like the way she's mixing that up there with the stomps and the movement, but Bannon's reading, trying to get the turn. Oh, nicely done.
I was going to say, I am not a fan of the foot stomps.
Oh, no, yeah.
They hurt so bad. You wouldn't think it, but they do.
The next day especially. Especially on a plane.
Now
Bannon's on the top.
I mean, this is a huge, huge position for Bannon to be in the last 90 seconds of this round. She needs to stay controlled, keep top position, and look to be offensive here. But Vera, she needs to aggressively look to get back up, reverse a position or get to her feet and get going.
And you can see Bannon's shucking things down, trying to move to full guard. Oh, and she's in. Oh, now she's in full guard.
Look, another triangle. Oh, my goodness.
She wants that triangle.
That was beautiful.
Beautiful, but risky, giving up top position.
Bannon's gone for the triangle now in the second round in a row.
She's got a lot more time to work this time around. She's got 45 seconds, and that looks tighter than the last one.
Yeah, especially the modification with her grip. Her hands gripped around the top there adds a lot of extra pressure and helps keep her from getting squeezed out on her legs.
30 seconds remaining in round number two as Bannon tries to close in that triangle.
And here I think Vera should just be on all defense. The knees are nice, but you saw she slipped and she wasn't able to keep her base there. Base is super important here. Hips close together, look for the pass. Seems like a short round to me. Ooh, nice elbows there from Bannon. That's exactly what you want to do. Get her thinking about something else and make it tight.
Huge round for Bannon there.
Bannon strong on her feet with those right hands, but then also strong when they get to the ground. Jules going in for that triangle again.
Yeah, she's got a lot of confidence in it, and I don't blame her. She is able to control the position. She's able to really put some damage there. And those elbows, that is icing on the cake for me. I love those elbows from the triangle.
Let's check in with Eve Edwards again. Your thoughts on that second round, Eve?
You know, Bannon looked really good in that second round. I feel that she was controlling the stand-up. The only parts of the round that she had a problem was when they were tied up. But as soon as they hit the ground, she kept advancing position, got to that triangle, and put a real threat on Vera in this round. So I believe going into this third round, she has the lead, and she just needs to keep the pressure up. Don't get on the bicycle, keep the pressure on, and potentially get another finish.
Megan, on the flip side, what are you thinking right now if you're Nadia Vera?
Vera needs to get going. She needs to let her hands go. Once she starts bringing those combinations together, she starts to have a lot of success. When she's on top on the ground, she has success. When she had Bannon up against the cage, she was having success. She's just not pulling the trigger. She's not setting up her combinations, and she needs to do just that. She's letting Bannon set the pace of the fight. She needs to make a change, and she needs to make it fast.
Third and final round is underway, and one of these two athletes is about to get her first Invicta FC victory. Boy, they are exchanging some serious blows.
Nicely done there by Vera. Nice read. Bannon with good defense. Oh, beautiful. They're really letting it all go right now.
Well, I think if I'm Vera's coaches, I'm telling her, you gotta go. You have to get going because she's, in my opinion, losing this fight. The first one was close, but I think with the submission attempt and the control and the standout by Bannon in the first round, I think she won that round. And I think she clearly won that second round. She needs a finish in this third to win this fight. She needs to get going.
I have to say, I was impressed with her giant knee in the second round. And I think knees and elbows would do her a lot of good right now. She really does stay on the attack in the clinch. And if she could just get those in there, create that space, throw the knee and keep control, she might have some real success in that finish. Meanwhile, Shauna's using that overhook. Oh, not anymore. Trying to get off that fence, and she's able to with strikes.
Vera with the bit between her teeth right now. She just caught a left hand, though, from Bannon.
And Vera's moving forward.
Big overhand right from Bannon that time.
Moving forward, but getting tagged. Yeah. Oh, nicely done there.
Kick from Bannon as well.
I do admire Vera's tenacity.
I mean, she's just walking forward like a zombie. She's like a Terminator out there.
Bannon, when she hits, oh, nicely done.
Everything that Bannon throws at her, she just walks it down.
And what does that do psychologically to Bannon? She's connected on so many shots, but Vera just keeps coming.
It can be so disheartening. You've given everything. You've tried to submit this girl twice now. She's survived. You've hit her with everything you've got, and she still doesn't go away. That can be so disheartening, but I think Bannon is she's just so
nicely
done
there.
Oh, my goodness.
You can see Vera turning in, going belly down, going right into her guard.
I mean, and this is where Vera needs to avoid.
Vera.
It's very obvious that Bannon has an insane offense from her guard on her back, and this, if I was Vera, I would escape, get back up, stand the fight up. She's having success on the feet right now. Do not be where it's better for Bannon to be, because she knows that she can hit that triangle when she wants.
2 minutes remaining in the third and final round.
Again, Bannon using the cage to climb. Vera trying to stay controlled on the top, find her position to hit, and Bannon is setting up that armbar.
I love listening to Kylie Hullahan and his accent.
Now look at the way Bannon is trying to dig her left toes into the grip. She wasn't able to, but she's got some interesting grips. Vera now trying to stay tight on those hips.
That's beautiful ground and pound there by Bannon from the bottom. I mean, and they add up. They hurt and they add up over time.
And Vera is continuing to try to advance her position. See, I think Bannon's arm is actually trapped between her legs,
which is also trapped over Vera's arm. It's like Tetris out here.
Yeah, it's a strawweight pretzel.
Less than a minute remaining, guys.
I really admire that they just keep striking, though.
Yeah.
They move, they grapple, they strike. These are two women who love to fight.
Persistence.
Yeah, and again, creative cage work there from Bannon. She's always trying to get her hips to a better position. Nadia Vera disengaging there. Smartly done.
Well, she's only got 30 seconds
right
left.
Right hand.
Ooh. Bring me back to my Taekwondo days. Beautiful.
Beautiful.
Bannon comes firing forward
and
now, trying to close this out.
She's listening to her coach so well. He asked for the blitz. She
Whoa,
hit the blitz.
Beautiful.
Look at this.
Look at that.
Oh, my goodness.
She wanted a finish in this fight, and she just might get it.
Oh.
Bannon trying to put an exclamation point at the very end on this.
Wow.
Oh,
how tough are these
ladies? The heart on both of these ladies.
So we are at the conclusion of bout number one tonight. Shauna, Mama B, Bannon, and Nadia Vera. And boy, did Bannon, we thought she had a flair. And boy, did she close this thing out with a flurry.
She really did. She started off strong. She worked through adversity. Her striking was on point. Her ground game was on point. Her offensive submission game was incredible. She really showcased the high-level nature of her career and her abilities as an athlete, and man, but the toughness of Nadia Vera.
Right.
She was a Terminator out there. She didn't stop walking Bannon down and really made it a dogfight out there tonight.
She did. She made her work, and she did not give her a finish in her third fight, which is what Bannon really wanted, that third fight finish. Wonderful way to start out this evening with Invicta FC.
Two competitors making their debut, and they showed themselves very well here tonight. I don't think either one of these competitors has anything to hang their heads about. You mentioned it, Vera. Boy, she tasted a lot of shots, and she just kept coming.
She really did.
I was going to say, I mean, you probably see this kind of rivalry between Ireland and Mexico in soccer, Nate, but it's nice to see it when it's fisticuffs as well.
Yeah, they both have a rich tradition when it comes to the MMA world as well. No doubt about it. Well, we are off and running here. Shauna Bannon and Nadia Vera going the distance in their three-round bout. And now for the results, let's send it into the cage and Joe Martinez.
Well, five fans, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. Here are the totals 30-27, 30-27, and 29-28. All for your winner by unanimous decision. She is still undefeated, Shauna Mama B. Banner!
Guys, she came out firing. She showed her prowess on the ground as well, and then finished with a flurry.
She really did. She listened incredibly well to her coaches. Every time I hear them giving her instructions, she's doing just that. She listens well. She has the X factor. She's got the charisma and just an incredible athlete all around. And that was showcased tonight.
All right, let's hear from the winner now as Shauna Bannon is standing by with our Allie Trost Martin.
Shauna, Mama B. Bannon, congratulations.
Thank you so much. I'm buzzing, you have talent! Woo!
What is going through your mind as you await that decision?
She's a tough bitch. She's a tough girl. The Mexicans are tough, but come here. I'm so fucking happy, yes! Woo! Sorry, Dad, for cursing.
You mentioned your opponent. How difficult was this fight?
To be honest, I knew she was tough, but I didn't think she'd be that tough. She gave me a brilliant fucking fight. Unreal. Fair play, Nadia. Deadly.
Shauna, you have a lot of people watching and cheering you on from Ireland. What do you have to say to them right now?
Honestly, all the messages, texts, calls I've got over the past few days, I feel like he's here with me. I'm overwhelmed with all the supports. We have to bring Invicta to Dublin. Let's go!
Lastly, your name, Mama B.
Yeah.
I know your little one means a lot to you.
Yeah.
What message do you have?
He's probably asleep in bed now, but that was for you, baby boy. I'm home Friday and we have lots of cuddles and chocolate. Love you.
Let's hear one more time for Shauna Mama B. Bannon.
And from ground and pound to cuddles and chocolate, guys, I don't know about you, Jules. I'm up for a trip to Dublin,
oh,
Ireland.
Oh, yes, please.
Say no more.
What about this performance, though?
She looked incredible. Even through adversity in positions like this, she was able to create space, throw up a lot of offensive submissions, and just showcase her well-roundedness for someone so young in her career. The submissions, the strikes, the right hand kept landing all night for Bannon. She listened to her coaches incredibly well. And in round two, she just seemed to set herself apart from Vera. The right hand landed, the strikes, the look at the takedown, the submission again, and she just showcased the evolution of her game. And for someone who is only now 3-0 in their career, she showed incredibly high level striking, jiu-jitsu, and just overall athleticism. And I mean, Vera just brought it to her every single second of this fight. She made her dig deep for this win, and I think it just showcased how incredible both of these women are, and I'm excited to see what both of them do going forward here at Invicta.
Yeah, Jules, we're gonna see these two going forward. This isn't the last we saw of Bannon or Vera, but Bannon gets the big win in our first fight of the night. Coming up next, we've got Montserrat Monster Rendon versus Brittney the Quiet Storm Cloudy in a bantamweight brawl. Coming up next, it's a bantamweight bout as the Quiet Storm, Brittney Cloudy, battles Montserrat the Monster Rendon. A former track star and boxer, Cloudy looks to use her range and athleticism to get her first Invicta win in her fourth try.
I've never fought anyone who's like a pushover. I've fought high-quality opponents, and I've learned from those fights. It taught me a lot about myself. That has definitely given me a lot of experience of going to battle with really strong and powerful, talented women. So I know that reflects upon me as well. So we'll see how she matches up with an opponent who's has a lot more skill set and strong and who's gonna bring it to her.
Looking to rain on Cloudy's parade is Montserrat the Monster Rendon, Rendon rides a four-fight winning streak into her Invicta debut tonight.
I'm prepared for all, but I know that I want, and I'm going to raise my hand in that night.
Coming up next, it's the quiet storm, Brittney Cloudy against Montserrat the Monster Rendon. Megan, you mentioned it, a lot of debuts tonight. Six overall, and this is one of them. Montserrat the Monster Rendon. She is a jiu-jitsu instructor in Cancun, Mexico, and she wants, she says, to set an example for women fighters coming out of Mexico that it can be done the jiu-jitsu way, and she wants to put that on display here tonight.
She really does. Another one training with Alexa Grasso, Invicta alum and UFC staple. And she trained with her a couple of years ago, and she took a lot of inspiration from both Alexa Grasso and Irene Aldana, much like Nadia Vera. There's not a lot of women professional athletes in MMA coming out of Mexico, so this is a huge opportunity for her to come through the same way as her idols have. And I am so excited to see her showcase tonight. She's the mother of a 9-year-old son, and she teaches BJJ to her kids' classes, and she wants to be a motivation to the kids that she teaches, to her son, and to women from Mexico. And I am so excited to see what she can do here tonight. Storm Brittney Cloudy, 0-3 in her Invicta career so far. There's an old adage, though, that as long as you learn, you never lose. You either win or you learn. She feels she's learned a lot, Jules, from those first three bouts. She's going to be a different fighter, set to prove something here tonight.
Yeah, you know, and Nate, I'm old school, and coming up in MMA, we used to say, you know, boxing is about records, but records are for DJs. MMA is about the experience, it's about the fight, but it is important to win. And Brittney Cloudy has recognized that. She has relocated to Main Street Boxing and MMA in Houston, and she said she's rededicated her life to things. She said in her last fight against Serena De Jesus, she had an incredible first round, and she said, I want to give as much as I did the entire fight as I did in that first round. I want to show you what I'm made of. I am doing this for me. I'm making it about me, and I am going to be the artist out there. It's not about what I'm doing right and what I'm doing wrong. It's about me being the artist.
Two long, lean athletes. Montserrat Rendon and Brittney Cloudy. Let's go to the tail of the tape. Brought to you by Verdict Tournaments. And the Montserrat Rendon 33, Brittney Cloudy 32. By the way, if you want more information on the Verdict Tournaments, just take your phone out and scan that QR code that you see there. There is a reach advantage for Brittney Cloudy. She comes from a boxing background as well. She's going to try to put that to use here tonight. Now let's send it into the cage to Joe Martinez.
And now, fight fans, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. Three rounds, this in the bantamweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, a Brazilian jiu-jitsu practitioner standing 5'8" tall. Weighing in officially 135 pounds in four fights, she is perfect with four victories and no defeats. Here's the undefeated bantamweight from Cancun, Quintana Roo, Mexico, Montserrat, Monster Rendon. And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist is 5'9" tall. She weighed officially 135.5 pounds, and in 8 fights holds an even record of 4 victories and 4 defeats. Fighting out of Houston, Texas, here is Brittney, the Quiet Storm Cloudy! And your referee in charge of the action, Marcio La Selva.
And with that, fight number 2 of the night is underway. The bantamweight bout. Brittney Cloudy in the red top versus Rendon in the all green. You've got one with a boxing background, one with a jiu-jitsu background. It's always fun to see contrasting styles and how they assert themselves in the early going.
Nice feints there from Cloudy. Rendon really content to go right down the middle, hit that jab. Oh, nice kick there.
Cloudy starting off with the right hand that time.
A little bit of a feeling out period right now between these two. Figuring out the timing, figuring out the range, figuring out the speed. I think that's one thing that Cloudy is definitely doing right now. She's hitting a lot of her lateral movement, looking to see how her speed adjusts. A huge right hand there. That was beautiful timing there.
You know, the last time we saw Brittney Cloudy fight, she said everything follows the jab, but already a couple of times we've seen her open up with that right hand.
And that's when we talked to her earlier this week, she talked about training to win in the gym. She had a lot of difficulties with that throughout earlier in her career, but she's really double down and focus on making good decisions in the gym that will translate across into a 3-round fight.
You can see that Cloudy is being very cognizant not to present a stationary target right now.
Oh yeah, she has excellent movement there. And Rendon, I actually really, oh, she's tying up. I was gonna say, I'm expecting the takedown attempt any time here. Although she has good striking, Rendon, she really does like to do her work on the floor. Cloudy having none of it. Just stylistically, you can see the heavy front foot compared to the movement and the kind of slipping we see from Cloudy. Very light on her feet. Rendon is a specimen, though. Nice slips there. She has a lot of power in her hands. Beautiful right hand.
And I think Cloudy is very cognizant of that power and making sure that she is moving, because, I mean, when you look at them both, Rendon does seem to look like she packs a punch. Mm-hmm. And so I think Cloudy definitely has to be very careful of making mistakes and being hit with that big right hand.
That big right hand, and also that check hook. It's not quite a full check hook, but Rendon has slipped to that angle several times and hit with her left hand.
2 minutes remaining in round number 1. Cloudy throwing a jab that time.
Nice.
Catches her with a right hand as Cloudy.
It's almost like she uses that hook to evade to the left, away from that right hand, to set up that angle for Rendon's own right hand.
Nice, yeah, nice right hand to the body there. But no, you're right. She's doing a very nice job of reading that, and it does take away some of the movement from Cloudy, right? Like, Cloudy likes to move to the right a lot. Tie up for Rendon. Cloudy's got the underhook there, looking to spin off the cage. You can see Rendon was really trying to control on the biceps there when she lost underhook position.
Less than a minute remaining in round number 1. Cloudy so far able to keep this thing on her feet.
And, oh, nice. Rendon doesn't seem to mind to be on her feet.
Right.
I think she'd prefer the takedown, but she knows she's hitting hard when she lands.
I mean, she's having some success. I mean, it's kind of one of those situations where if you're not able to take your opponent to the ground where you want to, you're forced to stand and strike. But I feel like she's having some success. Those right hands are landing. Those check hooks are landing. I just think she's starting to find the timing and the movement of Cloudy a little bit. But Cloudy, man, her footwork is just phenomenal.
Cloudy is also picking up the pace on her feet quite a bit here. I mean, she's always been fast, but I think she's understanding the aggression that she needs to put out here. Because when Rendon hits, she hits hard.
She does.
We saw Brittney Cloudy before the fights started tonight. She was in the cage going through her footwork. You knew that was a big part of her game plan, something she's got to get right here tonight.
Absolutely. I mean, when you're going against somebody who's such a solid fighter too as Rendon, who just creates such a big mass coming at you, you really have to be able to move.
She really does. But I think with Cloudy, the movement is what's going to be key going forward. If she can keep up that pace, keep up that movement and the footwork, I think as the fight progresses, Rendon could potentially slow down, because when she's throwing with a lot of energy. So it's going to be interesting to see how they both pull up as the fight progresses.
Eve Edwards, what did you make of round number one?
Round number one was very close. I give that edge to Cloudy in that round, but what I feel that Cloudy needs to do, she needs to double up on that jab and then throw combinations after that double jab. I think she has the distance and the range down. I think this is a tough round.
Did we see a cautious Cloudy in round number one, Megan?
I would say we've seen her be a little bit cautious in the first, say, minute and a half of that round. But even though with her movement, she's being aggressive with it. She's being aggressive, she's constantly moving forward. She's walking Rendon down. And that's one thing that we've seen in her last couple fights. She kind of stopped that forward pressure as the fight progressed, and that was how she lost. She has made incredible improvements, as we're seeing right now. The aggression, the speed, the power, the movement, and she's throwing singular punches right now. She throws two punches. She's throwing one or two punches. I would like her to throw a little bit higher combinations, like when she slips, rip two or three more punches. Let's see how Rendon can stack up with her striking defense against slightly higher number combinations.
And I think Cloudy's definitely getting a read on that slip that Rendon was getting in the first round. That left hand is not landing as much. Cloudy is landed there, but she's keeping that hand up. She's getting that elbow tight. I particularly like how Cloudy will fake with the right and then hit the right down the middle. She knows leading with the right was successful for her. Now she's using it as a feint as well. But Rendon, she is not backing down. Like, she's continuing to move forward. She's continuing to throw punches. And like
a little
we
blood
saying,
trickling down from the left nostril of Rendon right now.
And she's always ready to answer back, isn't she?
Well, you can just see the look on Cloudy's face right now in her eyes. She is locked in.
I mean, look at Rendon's striking style. It's very lead leg heavy. She throws with a lot of powers. I would like to see Cloudy maybe mix in the calf kicks, mix in the leg kicks, and really start doing some damage on that lead leg. And that's going to ease up on the power of Rendon, because she's not going to be able to posture on that leg as well as she would.
I do love the right hand off of the right hand. I think that's landing very well. Nice.
Oh, beautiful.
A combination from Cloudy. Halfway through round number two.
And I think that's actually a very smart strategy for Rendon. If she doesn't get that takedown, be ready to fire, even fake the takedown and come up firing. That's how she's going to penetrate. That's how she's going to get Cloudy, thinking about her legs and leaving herself open for an attack.
Well, my thing with Rendon is she's not really setting anything up, Julie. Everything is very, there's no fainting. There's no, you know, slipping. There's nothing. It's very stationary down the pipe, which is such an easy target for Cloudy to read. So I would love to see Rendon use her feints, fake some punches, look to take down, and then continue to striking. But Cloudy is just doing such a good job of reading that, because she's not setting anything up.
And I think, you know, Rendon was able to land another one of those kind of modified checks. Ooh. A beautiful knee there from Cloudy.
That looked like it hurt.
Left knee from Cloudy caught Rendon.
And, you know, that heavy front leg at this point should be leading to a double leg. You know, that jab, jab. If you're stepping with that much force going forward, you really need to keep that drive up. Drop your level. Go for the legs.
Range. I agree, Julie.
For the most part, she's tried upper body tie-ups for the takedown. I just think a shot right here. Let's hit those legs now. Hard to do with somebody who's in motion the way Cloudy is all the time. Nice inside leg kick there. I do like the up jab and the modified check hook, but it's just not doing enough yet. Oh, hey! I say that beautiful spin back fist.
Goodness.
Lovely.
The sound on that spinning back fist. Good Lord.
Cloudy seems unperturbed.
Cloudy trying to work that jab this time as we're down to 20 seconds remaining in round number two.
Beautiful.
Cloudy
up those
coming forward now.
Oh, my
listening
goodness.
To Eve Edwards on that one, putting it together.
Now it's turning into a street fight.
She's got that, the slip and rip. She is
beautiful. Just staying right on her. Flying knee attempt. All right.
Well, things picked up a notch there in round number two, didn't they?
Absolutely. You know, Rendon, I would say she probably dropped that one, but she definitely got her own punches in there. She landed her, but Cloudy really came even more alive, showing a variety of movement right there.
Well, we saw that spinning back fist from Rendon as well.
Beautiful spinning back fist, but that was the only big moment, I feel, for Rendon in that round. She needs to use her feints, set things up. She's just not pulling the trigger. She's throwing one, maybe two punch combinations, and it's not working. We need to adjust now.
And Cloudy had some serious success there with those knees.
Beautiful.
Reading them off of the right hand of Rendon. Reading, like you said, her heavy weight on the front leg. Just beautiful opening, pinpoint accuracy.
Eve, what did you make of round number two?
Man, I think you ladies had everything right in that round. Where Megan said that she'd like to see more combinations out of Cloudy, I completely agree, especially adding the leg kick to that. And then with what Julie was saying about Rendon, changing levels and attacking the shot at a different level, because that's really the only offense that she's not giving to Cloudy, and Cloudy's shutting everything else down.
Brittney Cloudy came into this fight determined to get a win. After those three losses, she wanted to change. She wanted to prove to everybody that she had learned from those three experiences. Now she is one round away. Let's show a look at Tommy Toehold. Sometimes the best jiu-jitsu is punching someone in the face. At the end of the day, it's a fight, right, ladies?
Amen. Amen to that.
Exactly.
Another knee attempt there. Like, Brittney Cloudy is in the pocket, but never in range to get hit. She's always getting that head just out of the way. Rendon must be a little discouraged in that, but doesn't, you know, she's not changing things up yet, not changing that tactic.
When we spoke with Cloudy earlier this week, she said, in that last fight, she faded as the fight progressed. So she went back, she focused on her training, she focused on her conditioning, and oh my goodness, do we see a new and improved Brittney Cloudy tonight? The pace, the pressure, the aggression, the head movement, she is consistently coming forward. She's ready for everything, she's seeing everything, and she is in the zone right now.
Yeah, her defense has been incredible.
Incredible, Nate.
And we've seen like three or four body shot attempts from Rendon right there. They landed a couple times in the first round, and a couple of these landed, but I think that should have come earlier in the fight.
Great to have Tommy Toehold weighing in, by the way, as Brittney Cloudy looking to make a statement here in round number three.
Rendon's getting bloody there. Cloudy is continuing the aggression, but still being a little bit more measured here, trying to pull out that counter strike. Oof, that's fast.
Can you close it out?
She is just a sniper in there right now, seeing absolutely everything. Deflecting, blocking, slipping, hitting. It's a masterpiece that we are watching right now from Brittney Cloudy.
She said she wanted to show that she is the artist, that it's her MMA out there. And I think she is. Rendon continuing to stay in this fight, though. Discouraged, no doubt, and a little bit tired, but still looking for those big shots.
I mean, she has 2.5 minutes to work, Julie.
Mm-hmm.
And she looks like she wants to
nice right hand.
Make the most of it. She's not going away right now.
Boy.
Cloudy throwing that left uppercut that time.
And what I'm loving is at the end, or at the second half, towards the end of the round, she picks her pace up even more. Mm-hmm. And she just really makes her stamp on the division. But Rendon doing a really good job. Cloudy just is able to shuck her off so easily. And just Rendon just doesn't seem to have an answer for everything that Cloudy is showcasing
she
right now.
Also doesn't seem that committed to that takedown right there. Like, she was kind of content to let it go and get back into the striking. And that's where Cloudy's had success. Now she's clinching up again. Double underhooks. Cloudy was able to get the clinch, shuck her off. Oh, now attempting to trip her.
She has a much stronger body lock here.
On her back. This is where Cloudy's got to be really, really careful. She's done a great job in this fight. This is where she's got to settle in, find those little things.
Cloudy has been
there.
Able to stay on her feet this entire fight to this point.
She has, but now she's got very little to balance on in the cage. She's got one leg wrapped up. Rendon disengages, throws a knee, but continues to keep her smushed up against the cage. You can see Cloudy's working for that underhook.
And this is what Rendon should have been doing from round one. Just pressuring her on the cage,
nice
looking for that body lock, but man.
She's just surprised we didn't see it earlier.
Yeah, no, I really am. Like, as somebody who was,
said
she wants to showcase
again.
Her jiu-jitsu, she's been very content to box in this fight.
You know, and I think Cloudy had some excellent defense in earlier rounds. She was, oh, nicely timed there by Rendon.
There we go.
She's got Cloudy on the ground, and she's got to do fast work here.
30 seconds.
For Cloudy, I mean, her first victory in the IFC cage is seconds away. If she can stay composed, get back up, and ride this out, or finish her. Rendon getting heavy on those kicks to the legs.
And there is the horn for the close of round number three. The quiet storm Cloudy was anything but quiet in this game. She put on a clinic when it comes to footwork and defense. Is she about to get her first Invicta FC win, Jules?
I believe she is. You know, I saw her do the most damage. I think Rendon did a lot in this fight to try and finish, but I think Cloudy was ultimately, you know, the winner of almost all of the exchanges. Montserrat Rendon had some moments. Those spinning back fists were beautiful, and she did get that takedown in the end of round three, but I don't think that was enough to get the victory here, Nate.
All right, let's find out what the final score is. We'll send it in to Joe Martinez.
After three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. And here are the totals. Judge Carrero scores it 29-28 for Cloudy. Atwood, 29-28, Rendon. And Judge Bauer has it 29-28 for your winner by split decision. And still undefeated, Montserrat! Monster Rendon!
Wow. Well, I called that one wrong.
Oh, my.
Interesting decision there from the judges. I'd love to pick their brains on that one.
I would love to pick their brains because I completely disagree with that decision.
She had her moments, like I said, big damaging shots. But ultimately, I just thought Cloudy had the more.
Well, let's go to Allie.
Montserrat, the monster, Rendon. How are you feeling right now? What was going through your mind as you awaited that decision?
Oh, I'm very, very happy. All I want to say is thank you for the night, Oklahoma. And thanks for my team, SRA in Cancun, Mexico. Thank you for all the support, the team to MMA, the team to Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Special to Yupi, Suraj, Andrik, Perro, Edgarito, todos allá. Les agradezco muchísimo. A Jaime también, chuchas, gracias. Thank you también for my family and my amazing coach, Eduardo Cortez, and my boyfriend. Thank you for all the support. And all of this is for my son, Matias. See you tomorrow in Cancun. Hijo, te amo con todo mi corazón. Gracias a todos. Gracias.
You finally got this fight on the ground there in that final round. How difficult did your opponent make this fight tonight?
Yes, Brittney is very, very hard. It's a good opponent. I want to go to the ground until the first round, but I still go in front in this fight, and that's the result.
What's next for the monster?
I want to all the of his opponents. I want to fight. I'm make for this for MMA and nothing. Lo que venga es bienvenido.
Let's hear it one more time for the monster.
Thank you, Oklahoma.
Victorious in her Invicta debut. Maybe controversial when it comes to the decision. We thought she wanted this fight to go to the ground. It was basically standing and striking all fight long, guys, but she gets the decision.
And you know, we don't see maybe the things that the judges saw, and we don't see the way it's not against Montserrat Rendon, because she definitely gave us a tough performance out there, a great debut with the organization. And I think she's got a long way to go in this division, and I'm excited to see what she pulls out next. But I don't think Brittney Cloudy should go down with her head down today. I think that was a great fight.
I mean, one thing when we look at this fight is the constant pressure that Rendon did bring to the table. She never backed down, she's constantly moving forward. She looked for the takedowns, didn't have success with it until the very end, but she was constantly looking to pressure forward, take it to the ground, and she did a really good job of controlling those stances when she was in those positions. But man, definitely a very controversial decision in my opinion.
Same.
Okay, so controversial decision, but Montserrat, the monster Rendon, is victorious. Coming up next, we've got a flyweight matchup. Poliana Botelho versus Helen Peralta. This is one of the fights that Megan was most excited about watching, and it is coming up next.
Coming up next, it's a matchup of flyweights as Helen Ianza Peralta faces Poliana Botelho. The always feisty Peralta carries a 5-1 Invicta record into tonight's bout. A professional chef in her spare time, Peralta is planning to carve up her opponent tonight.
I'm not sure what I need to do to make sure I get my hands right. I know I will do that, but I'm not sure how, and I actually like that, because before I would spend so much time concerned about the result and the outcome of what I'm doing that it would take away from what's happening in the moment. And I feel like being in the moment is what gets you in that state of flow. I'm gonna walk into this fight like I'm going to the fridge to get a snack, and then I'm just gonna go for whatever is there.
Looking to get into Peralta's kitchen tonight is former Brazilian national wrestling champion, Poliana Botelho. Botelho is looking to bounce back from a 3-fight losing streak as she makes her Invicta debut tonight.
Eu acho que eu sou uma lutadora mais completa que ela. Ela tem suas qualidades, sim, mas eu acredito que eu tenho mais armas do que ela. E eu tenho, além de boxe, eu tenho um chute, joelho, cotovelo, então acredito que eu sou muito mais perigosa que ela.
Coming up next, it's Helen Peralta versus Poliana Botelho.
Megan Botelho is a UFC veteran making her Invicta FC debut here today. I know you're excited to watch her fight tonight.
I am. Incredible striking. And that's one thing I've always loved about watching Botelho is her striking. She's incredibly tough. She's ready for whatever. She's an aggressive style. She's got good hands. And she just wants to showcase that. When we spoke with her earlier this week, she said that she didn't feel like she was able to truly demonstrate all of her skills in a lot of her recent fights, and she wants to do that tonight. And she feels like with a win over Helen Peralta, who has been a staple of the flyweight division here in Invicta, with a win, she wants the title. After that, the title is vacant. Marina Rodriguez vacated it earlier this year. She wants the title, and she's ready to showcase that tonight and put on an absolutely incredible performance.
Jules, she's got 6 knockouts on her resume, but she does want to be recognized more for what she can do on the ground as well.
Yeah, you know, she has extremely good jiu-jitsu, and she actually has a national championship in Brazil for wrestling. She just said, you know, there was a lot more striking in my fights. I just really liked being there, but I am a well-rounded, I'm a more well-rounded fighter than Helen Peralta, and I'm going to show that tonight.
In her Invicta debut, Poliana Botelho. Jules, Helen Peralta has a little spice to her, doesn't she? I mean, I'm using that cooking analogy maybe a little too far, but she has got some pep. She's got some fire to her. She comes into the cage with an attitude.
She certainly does. You know, I remember telling you, Nate, I was so disappointed she's on top 30 because we're not going to see her in the Invicta cage again. And lo and behold, she's in the cage again. She is a walking soundbite, a tough, tough lady. Very, very funny, but also serious about fighting and serious about entertaining. She says there's an entertainment aspect to MMA. I have my own style. I like to fight, but I will entertain you too. One of my favorite lines from Helen Peralta is actually a technical. She says, I like to throw haymakers, because people don't train for that. They don't train for the wild shots, and that's what's entertaining, knocking people out that way.
Because she said she walked around as a kid just wishing somebody would. And she finally found the outlet for that type of energy in Invicta. Let's go to the tail of the tape presented by Verdict Tournaments. Again, for more information on Verdict Tournaments, just check out that QR code right there. 33-year-old Botelho, 34-year-old Peralta. And the reach advantage is in favor of the Brazilian. Now let's send it into the cage to Joe Martinez.
Well, fight fans, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. 3 rounds in the flyweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, a striker standing 5'8" tall, weighing in officially 125.5 pounds in 13 fights. Her record stands at 8 victories with 5 defeats. Fighting out of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, here is Poliana Botelho. And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist is 5'5" tall. She weighed in at the flyweight limit, 126 pounds, and holds a professional record of 5 victories with 2 defeats. Fighting out of Fairfield, Iowa, here is Helen Ianza Peralta. And your referee in charge is Kevin Nix.
Botelho versus Peralta in the flyweight division. Peralta in the all black, and Botelho in the black and yellow, and we're underway. This one is going to be a good one.
Something about Botelho this week is she was all business. And Peralta, all violence.
Incredibly aggressive. She calls herself an educated brawler with her fighting style, and already with that huge leaping Mark Hunt-esque hook to close the range, we are seeing that brawling style right from the get-go, Nate.
I loved what she had to say when she said, I know I'm gonna get my hand raised, I just don't know how. She said she used to picture how she wanted that victory to come, but now she wants to just be in the flow and see how things go, and we'll see if she's in the flow here tonight.
And Botelho showing her well-roundedness, getting those shoulder bombs in there, fighting for bicep control, her back up against the cage, but still staying on the attack. Peralta keeping her nice and tight back to the cage, looking for that trip. I love the way they're fighting just for these small things within this exchange. For Helen, it's about hiking her up, getting her higher. For Botelho, it's really about getting as many attacks as possible so she can switch and shift the positioning of Peralta.
I mean, Peralta has double unders here. She's doing a really good job of not giving Botelho any space, but I think Botelho needs to aggressively start switching her hips so she can grab that underhook so she can create space, reverse the position. But Peralta, she's just so strong in these exchanges. She has very strong in the position of the over-under in the clinches. But Botelho is doing a good job of trying to close.
Yeah, she's got that left underhook. She was reaching around the back, and she's now able to secure a better position.
Looking for her own.
Beautiful, has Peralta up against the cage now. Fighting against the cage is like, the practice that you have to do right there just to gain an inch. The amount of effort it takes to off-balance somebody and continue to look for a way to attack them. Really technical, cool stuff right there. Botelho is definitely looking to get a high positioning and a low positioning for a lift or a shift. I like how she's doing that. Helen Peralta's reading and kind of backpacking around her, looking for that head position, but also looking to turn back.
And Peralta's the one with the back to the cage right now in the all black.
Ooh, spinning attempt there from Botelho. Gets her up against the cage again.
I love the initiative, looking for that spinning elbow, but man, not the best decision giving up control like that, Julie.
She seems pretty content. I mean, she was able to get Helen back to the cage. And, it's kind of the smothering and turning war between them. Botelho is really reaching between the legs a lot of the time, trying to block out the hips. When you have underhooks, now we have Peralta doing the same thing. Looks like she's trapped up in there. I like those palm strikes to the ear. That could be really disconcerting. Nice.
There's a right hand from Peralta.
Botelho just staying busy with those knees. It can get her balance a little bit off. You don't want to be on 1 foot for too long up against the cage.
I mean, right here, Botelho has the underhook. I want to see her aggressively look to escape out that side, reverse the position. beautifully done there. Right as I say.
She makes it look effortless. And you know it's so hard. After these days, I don't know about you, Megan, but after cage clinch days, I was a wreck. So tired. Nice knee there from Peralta. Oh, I like the way Botelho's reaching for that leg and also throwing knees at the same time. She's got the left underhook, abandons it, trying to get in on that single leg, unable to.
Just seconds remaining in round number one.
Wow.
What do you make of the first 5 minutes of this one, Megan?
I mean, for two strikers, I don't think we see much striking.
Right.
I mean, both of them showcasing offensive and defensively cage wrestling. Mm-hmm. Peralta doing a really good job of showing her strength, but Botelho really showcasing her high-level wrestling, her ability to switch positions, control the position, and just really stifle that aggressive and strong control that Peralta brings to these exchanges.
And as much as Peralta likes to throw those haymakers, she has some great dirty boxing. I think she actually pulled back on that just a bit to match Botelho's wrestling on the cage. She really wanted to win in those clinch exchanges for position. There was a lot of wrist grabbing, a lot of attempts for bicep control there. Sophisticated turns as well.
And with that, round number two is underway. Peralta comes out swinging.
Botelho doing some fakes and feints. She told us some of her strategy for this. Definitely to employ the feints if it was going to be a striking battle. When you give up height the way Peralta is a bit, staying in there tight on somebody is a good idea. Trying to take that height away from that reach away from them.
Well, we've got verdict scoring underway, so for an update on that, let's check in with Eve Edwards.
The verdict scoring for this round is going to be pretty tight. The both women were pushing up against the fence, but I agree with the fans, man. I think Botelho was in more control, and she did more offensively in those clinches. I think the fans have this one right.
Fans voting on verdict. It was a close first round, guys. And Eve agrees with the fans. What do you think?
I mean, I agree. I think the fans have it right in this one, but Peralta's doing a good job of trying to control the position here. And I think she's doing a really good job of getting that body lock. I would just like to see her do a little bit more with it.
Oh, beautiful.
Oh, beautiful.
She was able to shuck off the shuck, so to speak, and continue the takedown.
This is huge here for Botelho. She just needs to stay patient, look to control the position, and start to do damage. Watch out for those submission attempts. You know, as we see, Peralta is looking to put her feet on the hips so she can create space to throw up some offense. So Peralta needs to be offensive here, but man, Botelho is doing a really good job. As we see, she just moved her up against the cage, so now Peralta's head is kind of squished against the cage there, which is not a pleasant position to be in.
No, it isn't. Peralta controlling the wrist there. Botelho very patient, working by inches to get higher up so she can get a strike or a pass, trying to ride the hips there. Peralta trying to get to her feet, gives up her back. She needs to scrape all the way to the side and make sure that back is against the cage. I love what Botelho's doing with that leg, though. That's the thing is, we talk about Helen Peralta. Oh, nice elbow. Talk about her exciting style and her striking, but she really does a great job in fights, looking for little things, looking for controlling positions. Botelho is all over her in this moment with those grips, and Peralta is very patient, trying to work those hands off, trying to improve her position. Gets the underhook.
Beautiful knee there. I feel like this fight is like a war in the clinch right now. It's literally a war of attrition on who can control their opponent in the clinch, in this over-under position on the cage. more than the other, Julie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is MMA. This is MMA in the tightest, most uncomfortable moments. And it really is showing Helen Peralta is not just a brawler. She is a technical fighter. She's able to read hip shifts and move around. And Botelho, you know, getting a little frustrated out there, but continuing her attack, continuing to find ways to attack Helen Peralta, even with her back on the cage. Now, she's really pinned up there. That is a tight position to be in. She's trapping her hand between her legs, yanking on the elbow, and doing the shoulder shuck. If Peralta could free that arm, she could shoot down because the legs are on one line, but that was a really very creative fighting.
One minute remaining in round number two. But Peralta showed some calmness in some difficult spots a couple of times in this round as well.
Beautiful.
As they go back to the ground.
I think these takedowns from Botelho are very crucial in the potential judging of this round. You know, when you have two fighters that are very similarly strength in a position and it's very back and forth, these takedowns are huge for Botelho right here.
Mm-hmm. And you can see Botelho grinding her head in, not letting Peralta create space to strike. And that's an interesting thing from the guard. You know, we talk about posturing up. But if Helen Peralta keeps her head down and Botelho doesn't shuck her hand off her head, she's also keeping pressure to prevent the striking. She's up now. Nice elbow there and nice return. Ooh, I love that elbow, trapping the wrist and sliding over. Botelho continuing to swarm, but Peralta finding her shots.
Round number two comes to a close. This is a difficult one right now, Megan Anderson.
It really is, but I think when you have a fight that is so closely matched, those takedowns, I feel like won Botelho that round in the eyes of the judges. Whilst Peralta did a phenomenal job of controlling the cage, doing some damage, and just showing her strength in these positions, those takedowns, I think, when you have a fight or a round where nothing significant really happens, things like takedowns, like this particular moment and the takedown at the end of the round, is what sets one fighter apart from the other. You know, but Peralta did have her moments, a lot of really good elbows, a lot of good control. Even on the ground, she was throwing up some strikes, but man, I think that definitely was a round for Botelho. Although I said that for the last fight, look at how that one went.
Yeah, anybody's fight, maybe going into round number three. Let's check in with Eve Edwards and find out what the fans think on verdict, Eve.
Well, this fight has been close throughout, but the fans see Botelho pulling away, and I believe it's what Megan said. You know, it's those takedowns, those positions where Botelho's in control, that's where she's pulling away, and I believe that's what the fans are seeing.
Eve, talking with you at breakfast about your favorite types of fights to watch, I feel like this is one you might really be enjoying.
Yeah, these guys are very, very tactical, and this fight right here is some of the hardest things in mixed martial arts, and also some of the smartest. You have to be very smart in these small openings, and you have to give up no spaces, but you have to be very, very sharp on your offenses and your defenses to have any success.
I agree with Eve. Like, it is, this type of fight is a game of inches. And it's very important that you're making the right critical decisions in these moments. Like, this type of fight is exhausting.
Right.
Grinding up against the cage, looking to take down. If any, I feel like this is more exhausting than anything else. Just this grinding style of fight is, but I think it's just attributed to how incredibly high level both of these ladies are. They're showcasing their skills in these very technical positions, as Eve is saying, and showcasing their cardio, because they keep going forward, they keep moving, keep switching positions. It's just, like I said earlier, a war of attrition in these particular moments.
Yeah, if you're not spending a third of your fight camp in this kind of clinch, you're doing it wrong. You absolutely need to be training this as an MMA fighter. This should be a huge part of your game, if to counter it or to finish from here. 100%. And they're both really nullifying the other's attacks very, very well.
And Jules, not just the physical fitness component, but the mental fitness part to stay focused and locked in this deep into the fight.
Absolutely. I've broken in fights because I was so sick of being held. Like, that's, they're both doing a brilliant job.
Kaytlin Young likes what the crowd has to offer here, an educated fan base here in Oklahoma City, and we would expect nothing less.
Love to hear it. Wrist control there to a knee there from Peralta, and you can see Botelho is still fighting on the inside. I love what she's doing. I love what Peralta's doing. It's interesting that she keeps trapping Peralta's hands between her legs and kind of wrenching on that shoulder. That's actually a very uncomfortable place to be.
Very unorthodox technique there, Julie.
Halfway through round number three.
Ladies, we know that the brain is also not only an organ, but it's also a muscle.
Yep.
And your body is absorbing so much of the red blood cells and the oxygen in this type of fight, but your brain needs that oxygen too.
And there was a really nice liver shot there from Peralta earlier.
Nice. Botelho.
I thought that would have affected Botelho. It looked like she was winded, but then you see what she did.
Just hit that knee on the entry. Beautiful. Not gonna lie, I was a little excited there. I thought we were gonna separate, see some striking.
Right.
Alas, now we're back in this position. And I mean, when you're looking from the outside, this type of fight can look very boring. But when you're in there, it is such a technical, grinding style of fight, and it just showcases the high-level nature of both of these athletes. And this is why this was one of the fights that I wanted to look for, because both of them, incredible strikers, but I think they're both showcasing their incredible wrestling.
Oh,
and grappling.
Lovely.
What a oh my goodness. The creativeness on that takedown, Julie.
Big knees there from Botelho. And you know, that takedown, the way she wedges a leg in there and then goes for the toss afterwards. Botelho's done that several times where she's actually wrapping and not doing the full kind of executed takedown, but kind of nudging, and then reading the balance and going. Lovely, especially the knees off of it.
It's worth revisiting what Botelho told us before this fight. Everybody knows me about my striking, but I want to show people that I can do things on the ground. I can use my jiu-jitsu and my wrestling. And it's been like there's been a magnet towards the cage far in this fight.
But Botelho continues to attack. I mean, she has had...
Oh, beautiful.
Botello's feeling it right now.
Yeah. Peralta moving forward, again, winging a little bit, but taking the punishment, throwing her own.
What I mean, with the guard of Peralta and her striking, it's very wild. So those knees are perfect right up the middle because those elbows aren't there to stop them getting through, Julie.
Final seconds of round number three. And an embrace between Botelho and Peralta, a hard-fought contest. Well, you can see the reaction from Botelho. She feels she did enough to get the decision here today. But that was a high-level fight for three rounds.
Oh, that was incredible, Nate and Julie. Like, just watching that, it was a war of attrition in the over-under position, which is some of the toughest positions and toughest style of fighting that you can get. But both of them incredibly high IQ, incredibly tough, a lot of pressure, a lot of aggressiveness, and just even at the end, continually to move forward and showcase, even at the end, they're still willing to throw down and put it all on the line. And that's why this was one of the fights that I wanted to see, because both of them have a ton of potential, a lot of skills, and it was on display tonight.
And really fantastic gamesmanship out there from Peralta. She stuck to her like a burr. Like, she kept Botelho up against the cage. She continued to initiate forward. When she was on the ground, she found ways to attack. They got back up. She really stayed on top of her. She was super, super tight. Even in awkward positions, she found a way to attack. So, you know, for Peralta, like, it may not be the big moment, big show, knockout overhand that, you know, she likes to do, but it was still a show, in my opinion. It was a show of high-level MMA. And a beautiful demonstration from both fighters.
Very technical display, like you said, Julie. And in these type of fights, it's all about the small, minute movements and details and positions, and that is what we've seen tonight.
at the conclusion of Botelho versus Peralta, before we get the official decision, let's check in with verdict.
And we look at the verdict scores. I mean, everybody has Botelho just ahead on this fight. A very, very tough fight. But let's see what the judges say, because they're the ones with the final say tonight.
All right, and for that, let's check in with Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. Here are the totals, 30-27, 30-27, and 29-28. All for your winner by unanimous decision, Poliana Botelho!
In her Invicta debut, Poliana Botelho. And you can just see what it means. As we take a look back at the highlights, guys, from this one, it went up against the cage early, and that's where it stayed for the majority of this bout.
It really did. You know, this was a war of attrition. This was a war of who fights and who wins the small exchanges. And Poliana Botelho really demonstrated her ability to shift around and shift positions. But Helen Peralta staying on top of her, reading a lot of those takedowns. Botelho was able to read the defense on the takedowns, get it to the ground. And I think that's what the judges were ultimately seeing. Really creative traps with her legs, setups, and aggression the entire time she was pinned. She got on top of Peralta. She did a lot of work on the ground when she could. Peralta did the work she could too, but I don't know. I love a cage battle. I love somebody who can fight going backwards, who can fight maybe when they're pinned, and continue to find ways to maneuver, continue to find ways to win in exchanges. I think Botelho edged her out, but I also think Peralta landed some very nice things. Those knees, though, in that third round. Beautifully done. Takedowns were really nice, even though Peralta was back up. And I don't know. It was just a great technical battle.
Coming up next, Hannah Guy versus Kaytlin Katniss Neal. Coming up next, it's another flyweight showdown as Kaytlin Katniss Neal meets Hannah Guy, two competitors who struck up a friendship during their time together on The Ultimate Fighter. Months later, they'll be locked in a cage against one another. For Kaytlin Neal, that friendship ends the second the cage door closes.
I know Hannah Guy is a really skilled jiu-jitsu artist. She is really great at taking the back. She's really good at arm bars. Her striking can use some improvement, but other than that, she is a game fighter. She's there to fight. She's there to bring.
Meanwhile, Hannah Guy has spent the past several months living a nomadic life, traveling the country and training at various gyms. That journey has brought a clearer sense of purpose for Guy as she readies for her Invicta debut.
I think I have multiple ways to victory. I see it ending in round two, mid-round. With a submission or the ref pulling me off of her because she couldn't get me off, so.
Coming up next, it's Kaytlin Katniss Neal versus Hannah Guy. Meanwhile, Kaytlin Katniss Neal was also in the Ultimate Fighter 30, and she said that the person she struck up the best friendship with was Hannah Guy. No idea that she would be in the cage against her just a few months later. But she said, look, that friendship ends the second the door closes. She's going to be ready for the fight.
Really was, Nate. And one thing when we spoke with her earlier this week is she said the Tough 30 experience was mentally one of the toughest things she's ever put herself through. Knowing the person behind the fighter on a day-to-day basis was incredibly tough. And this is her first time fighting a somewhat friend, you know, but she said she has a goal and she has a dream, and her opponent is standing in the way of that. She wants a highlight reel finish tonight to put on her resume, and she really wants to fight for women to inspire them to reach their goals and dreams. She said that her mom and her mom's best friend have been a true role model and inspiration for her. So I am excited to see Kaytlin Neal showcase her own inspiration to young women around the world right now.
Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for this flyweight bout presented once again by Verdict Tournaments. Take out that cell phone, scan that QR code, get all the details and information that you can. 27-year-old Hannah Guy, 30-year-old Kaytlin Neal. The reach advantage in favor of Neal. She is hoping to expose that and exploit that here tonight. Now let's send it into the cage to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. Three rounds, this in the flyweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, this mixed martial artist is 5 feet, 4 inches tall. Weighing in at the flyweight limit, 126 pounds. In five fights, her record stands at 4 victories with 1 defeat. Fighting out of D'Iberville, Mississippi, here is Hannah Guy! And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist is 5 feet, 8 inches tall. She weighed officially 125.5 pounds, and in 9 fights holds a record of 5 victories and 4 defeats. Fighting out of Las Vegas, Nevada, here is Kaytlin Katniss Neal. And your referee in charge, Marcio La Selva.
Let me go. Woo, yeah, let's go.
And we're underway. Hannah Guy dressed in the multicolored and tassels. And Kaytlin Katniss Neal in the all black. Guy with a message on her top that says happiness and violence.
And I feel like that aptly describes her as an individual as well.
Kaytlin Neal started this fight with a high left kick, one of her kind of trademarks. She's got excellent, excellent kicks and fights. But we saw a really nice calf kick there from Hannah Guy.
I got a kick to that standing front leg of Neal. And, you know, Jules, you and I talked about this a little bit. When you get in the cage against a friend, it's just a little bit of a different dynamic. Some people like it. Some people go to send a message right away.
Yeah, and I think both of them, we saw them both sprint to the middle of the cage. They really want to be the winner in this fight. Well, of course, you want to be a winner in every fight, but the thing is about fighting friends is you want to give them the respect of being your absolute best and trying to beat them up in a fight. Like, friendship ends in the cage, and it can be demonstrated by trying to win. Ooh, beautiful. Crescent kick there from Neal. Hannah Guy trying to make up for the range, getting a little bit closer there. Looks like she's got some red on her left eye. Ooh.
Guy grabs the leg of Neal.
And that takes some speed. Oh, attempts to trip her. but Neal reads it and is on top. One hook in on her back. Very good wrap up there.
Patient here. Guy doing a very good job of staying calm, looking to shuck Neal off.
And Neal's got that underhook. She's got that backpack position. So coming off the top of her, it's going to be a little bit harder for Hannah to do that without stripping the legs. Yes. Very nice for both of them.
Beautiful defense by Guy there.
Yeah, and the recovery from Neal was great. Just right back up ready to fight. Hannah Guy is so tough, man. She's fought bare knuckle. She's fought all over. Mm-hmm. She's a tough cookie. Kaytlin Neal, maybe a little bit more technical in the kicking department. But Hannah Guy is a monster on the ground as well.
I mean, Neal is doing a really good job of utilizing that lead teep to keep the range, because she knows she's got the range. She knows she has the advantage. And if she can keep it on the distance, she's going to have an advantage. And that teep is going to add up over time. She's landing in the same spot, and it's going to prevent Guy from, look,
ooh,
it's
hard body
the same
shot.
Spot every yep. time, mm-hmm. and it's starting to do damage. It's like the calf kick and going to the body. It might not pay off right away, but it starts to pay off as the fight progresses, and we're seeing that right now, because those shots are starting to visibly hurt Guy.
Oh, lovely.
Another one.
Yeah, damage in the bank. It adds up for sure, especially with body shots and low kicks. Nice hook kick there.
And she's making it almost impossible for Guy to close the distance.
Guy continues to push forward, not finding her range. And Guy's really trying to find the opening from a counter there to get inside, but I don't know. Seems like Caitlin's got a very nice awareness of where she needs to pull back. Oh, another beautiful crescent kick, axe kick attempt.
See, these moments right here, mm-hmm. as Guy is closing the range, she needs to keep it.
Oh, big right hand. Wow. Oh, she's hurt her.
She's damaged.
Oh.
To the ground she
big
goes.
Big hammer fist. Ooh, man. Swings right through. And a guy wrapping up.
Right back
oh,
up.
Oh, wow. Kaytlin lets her get back up. Oh, another body shot.
That's just precision Ooh. With that shot. Mm-hmm. She's seeing everything now.
You can see Guy is continuing to try to push forward, but she's tentative. She's definitely felt those body shots. And she got rattled there to the head as well.
All smiles from Kaytlin Neal. You can tell which fighter's feeling good about that first round and which one's glad to hear the bell.
You can, and I mean, it just showcased the toughness of Guy to keep moving through that tough position of, you know, being rattled a little bit and then taking those body shots, those shots to the head. It's definitely a clear win for Neal for this round, but for Guy, she needs to aggressively close that range. And when she does, she needs to keep it. She needs to keep the range small, because when she's allowing Neal to open up that range again, she's getting dismantled technically with the striking, and it's starting to add up. And you can see visibly when she's being hit in the stomach, she is cringing, and you could tell that it's the damage is starting to add up over time, and the momentum is really starting to switch over to Neal as we progress into this fight.
There's a confident strut from Kaytlin Katniss Neal as round number two opens up. All right, let's find out what the fans think via verdict as we check in with Eve Edwards.
Man, we look at the verdict scores, and the fans have Neal ahead, 0.84 versus the 0.24 for Guy, and I believe that's because Neal is controlling the distance. She's landing the shots at will, and we saw the damage that she did. Man, if you want to get in on this verdict voting, go to MMAverdict.com.
What does Hannah Guy, Jules, need to do to change up the way this fight is going right now in the second round?
Well, quite honestly, I would use the advice her coach on Tough 30, Juliana Pena, gave her, is to get ugly. Don't play this fight. Get on her. Get ugly. Make it an ugly fight. Make it a brawl. You'll find your opening there. She is a brawler. Hanagai is a tough, tough cookie, and she comes alive in later rounds. But unfortunately, Kaytlin Neal does too, and Kaytlin Neal came alive in the first round. Very strong. But I think she needs to get ugly. She just needs to find nasty shots. Grab that leg. Stay on top of her. Those body shots, man, that teep to the body is just such a deterrent for getting in close.
Well, Megan, with those body kicks, do you start to see guys' hands drop a little bit, opening herself up for shots to the head?
Yeah, potentially. And we kind of see Neal go for that towards the end of that round. She hit the body once, two, three, four, five times. Guy started to drop her hands. She push kick to the face. Mm-hmm. So it definitely sets it up, and it is a tool that could potentially be advantageous to us as the fight progresses for Neal. But I think for Guy, she's just, I don't think she has an answer for the range. I think that teep is just such an incredible tool for Neal in this fight, that she's able to dictate the pace and the range of this fight, which is playing to her advantage right now.
It really is, and it allows her that opportunity to land that right hand, which
every
is doing
time.
A lot of damage.
Every
yeah.
time, Julie. See, right here, she needs to keep it, like, keep going, keep pressuring, keep pressuring. Yes, that is it.
Don't worry about if it looks pretty. Don't make it technical, just go. But Kaytlin Neal, beautiful spin off there. Her angle, her footwork right there to get off of a dangerous position was great.
Halfway through round number two.
Kaytlin Neal, located in Utah, actually does her training at Syndicate Gym in Las Vegas, Nevada. Hannah Guy is a road warrior. She has her home gym in Mississippi, but she does like to get on the road in that ambulance and train with new people all the time.
She was camping in the petrified forest in New Mexico. She's out on the beach in San Diego, said she really saw a lot of the world, but she also saw more clearly how much she wants this to be a part of her life.
Big shots. Oh, that one hurt her.
You could tell
this
there
is the finish
there.
Time.
Three
this is exactly where Neal needs to, yep, get in there, take advantage. Oh, beautiful. Oh, throw those punches right there. Yeah,
oh,
that's it. Work
goodness.
The head.
Guy is almost fighting one-handed right now.
She's mad. Takedown attempt. Big shot.
The incredible heart on Hannah Guy right now. Visibly in pain, continues to keep moving forward, Julie.
Yeah.
Incredible grit.
Absolutely.
Insane grit. And Neal keeps going back to the well. Time, it just keeps landing. Oh, my goodness. That one hurt her again.
1 minute left in round number two. Guy is in a tremendous amount of pain from all of those kicks to the midsection she's taken through the first two rounds of this fight.
Kicks to the midsection and punches to the face.
Neal needs to stand back up.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Don't be down there.
But you can see Guy has been clenching at that right rib cage.
That's the thing about a liver shot is that can shut you completely down. Oy.
Kick to the face.
So fast.
She really flicks that up there.
Why?
Taekwondo-esque.
Yes,
beautiful.
Which is stances like that. Fakes low, comes up high again.
And it's those body shots that are setting up those head kicks.
She's invested in the body, and she's reaping the rewards.
Oh, sidekick, lovely.
And there is the close of round number two. Right now, Katniss Neal looks like it's been a walk in the park so far. She's wearing almost no damage whatsoever, and Hannah Guy is wearing all of the damage at this point. But again, Hannah Guy is showing what she's made of in many ways as well. If you take a look at some of these body kicks.
Oh, look at them. She hits like three teeps in a row, and it's just incredible pinpoint accuracy. There's one. There's two.
That's the one.
Right. And, like, look, Hannah is just determined to stay in this fight.
All right, let's check in with Eve to find out what the fans think on verdict.
Well, again, this fight has been a tough one for Guy. Neil is pulling ahead on his verdict scorecards. What I believe Guy needs to do is she needs to start committing to some feints, draw out that offense from Neil, and then follow that offense back. When that teep misses, follow it back, close the distance. She shows that she has some speed, use it.
Guy gets it up against the cage this time, and now down to the ground.
Neil's right back up though. She did a really good job of using that wizard to keep, almost using the weight of Guy as an extra pillar or wall to kind of help herself back up, Julie.
Yeah, and she did a really nice job of framing on that bicep control and pushing away, opening up the body of Guy. She didn't take advantage of that, but instead, or for a body shot, I should say, but instead used it to spin out. There is no quit in Hannah Guy.
I mean, it's something you see when you watch Invicta. These women are tough. We've seen it from the start of this fight card today all the way through this one, and it never ceases to impress you, but...
But it's always enjoyable.
Right? I mean, just the relentlessness and refusal.
Guy trying to stay in there close, get her shots in close, and not be at range for those kicks. Oy.
It just doesn't look like Guy has much pop on anything that she's throwing right now, and it's almost like she's half-heartedly going for the takedown and trying to throw strikes. I think she's just in such incredible pain right now with those body shots, and she's just not able to have an answer for the range.
Yeah, I think, and like when I say there's no quit in her, she just has to stay grinding. Like, that's her mentality. She's a fighter. She's a warrior. But she's not going to be able to land those hard shots. She's got to stay in and tight like this. Make it ugly. Don't worry about too much except getting to the positions where you know you can win. And it's probably not going to be a knockout from range. But she's all wrapped up here. She does come alive, especially in grappling in later rounds. But Katniss is, she's savvy to that.
She's just the faster fighter right mm-hmm. now.
She's fresh.
The fresher fighter.
Yeah. Yeah.
She's taken literally no damage. I think she has a little bit of bruising over her right eye. That's literally it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she looks like she's just started the fight. And Hannah Guy looks like she's been through a war already. But still she stands there in the center of the cage.
And continuing to take those body shots again and again and again. Just, oh my goodness, this girl is, the heart on her, Julie, mm-hmm. is, you cannot question it after
oh, no.
this fight.
Uh-uh.
Oh my
That's
goodness.
That same spot oh. on that right side.
This is making me hurt. Like, I'm good, thank you. I'll pass in some body shots for dinner. Thank you, though.
And I think it could really set up a left head kick knockout if timed right. That fake to the body, get her, you know, loaded down and then pop that kick up high. But her, you know, Kaytlin's right hand and her left hook have done a lot of nice work as well.
They did her homework and they've stuck to the game plan, and man, has it paid off tonight. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that guy is still trying to respond, still finding the openings, just not able to get in tight enough or hard enough.
There's another
there
kick
it is.
To the head from
hey.
Katniss
Neal. Another body
Neal.
Shot. Whoa, spinning back with a temp. Beautiful right hand afterwards as well.
30 seconds left.
I mean, it's just the constant pace.
Oof.
The
nice
pinpoint
knee.
Accuracy in her strikes, the body shots to the head, the volume, and just Neil has just from round one to round two.
Big knees to the liver, big body shot there.
Oh my goodness.
Continuing to just press forward and damage. Oh man.
An embrace between Katniss Neal and Hannah Guy. Mike Tyson used to say that everybody's got a game plan until they get hit in the face. But Katniss Neal seemed to have a game plan today, and she never had to waver from it because it worked from the jump.
Yeah, she didn't really get hit in the face either that
right.
much. Because
right.
of the range, because of the way she was able to control the range. And although Hannah Guy was in this fight in terms of moving forward and trying to press attacks the entire time, she was really shut down, I think, by the third round. Kaytlin's ability to land body shots, damage the liver, come up top, really paid dividends for her. And, just kind of a brilliant fight overall for her.
I mean, if you wanted to put on a performance, that was it. I mean, I know that she wanted a highlight reel finish, but Hannah Guy is an incredibly tough individual, incredibly tough athlete. So it was going to be hard to finish her no matter what. So it was an amazing display of heart from Hannah Guy. But Neil just showcased the teeps, the volume, the range, the pace. She had an answer for literally everything Hannah Guy threw at her tonight. And it was clear that there were different levels mm-hmm. tonight between the two of them.
Yeah, big show of respect between yep. them, though. They're still friends out of this 100%. They're probably going to end up training together, knowing how Hannah Guy loves to train with, you know, people she meets. But exceptional performance by Kaytlin Neal tonight, and all heart by Hannah Guy.
And all smiles for Kaytlin Katniss Neal as she put on a clinic here tonight. Before we get the official decision, let's check in with Eve and find out what the fans thought via verdict.
Man, the verdict fans have this fight. All three rounds going to Neal. Let's see if the judges here in Oklahoma get this one right.
And for that, let's check in with Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. The totals are 30-25, 30-27, and 30-27. All for your winner by unanimous decision, Kaytlin Katniss Neal!
All right, let's throw it into the cage to Ali Trost Martin with the victorious Kaytlin Katniss.
Here with Kaytlin, and Kaytlin, you said coming into this fight that you feel so aggressive, strong, and powerful. You sure looked it in there. How good did you feel in this cage?
Honestly, I felt awesome. That's exactly how I want to perform in all of my fights, and I'm glad I was able to put on a show for you guys and show my skills and what I could do. Obviously, I wanted the finish, but that's okay. We'll do that next time.
You don't get the finish, but you look to have executed the game plan perfectly. I know you have a history with your opponent, Hannah Guy. How much of what you saw in being in the tough house with her kind of helped you prepare for what you knew you were going to get here in the cage to open up for some of those body shots?
Yeah, I didn't know the body shots were really going to work on her. I thought she was just going to dive in for some crazy takedowns, so I knew I had to stay at range and stay to my game plan, which I think I did pretty well. But yeah, I mean, she did pretty much exactly what I expected.
And she put up a fight to the very end. I saw you all hugging it out there at the end. Yeah. What was that exchange like, and what kind of fight did she give you?
Do you know what? I feel, like, bad winning because I really do like Hannah. Like, from everybody from Team Pena, out of all the girls, like, I really liked her. And so I'm like, I feel bad, but She's a respectful opponent. I'm going to be rooting for her for all of her other fights from here on out. But yeah, I forgot your question. I'm not sure if I answered it or not.
Well, like you told me, you guys might go get dinner now. So yeah. Katniss, congratulations on the win. Let's hear one more time for our winner.
Thank you so much.
What an incredible performance that Kaytlin Katniss did. One judge, I don't think we've ever had this in MMA. One judge had it all three rounds, 10-8. I don't think we've ever seen that. All three rounds, 10-8 rounds for one judge ever in the sport of MMA. Look, somebody fact check me on that one. But man, Kaytlin Neal, the teeps, the power, the range, the pace. She had an answer for literally everything Hannah Guy brought to her tonight. And I mean, like we said, it is so tough fighting a friend, but they really showcased that they were able to separate friendship from opponents. Mm. And she put on an absolutely amazing performance. Technically beautiful in every single aspect, stopped every single takedown. She was accurate with her striking, accurate with the teeps, and those body shots, like I said earlier, they might not start adding up right at the start of the fight, but they will towards the end. And we showcased that is definitely a tough, tough cookie in Hannah Guy.
Absolutely. Fantastic fight.
Now coming up, a strawweight fight that we're very excited about. Valesca Machado versus Liz the Titan Tracy. Coming up next, it's a strawweight showdown as Liz the Titan Tracy takes on Valesca Tina Black Machado. Coming off a convincing win over Danielle Dynamite Taylor at a catchweight, the Titan Tracy believes she's worthy of a title shot. And tonight, she has the chance to prove she can make weight and make her opponent pay.
I've worked really, really, really hard at this fight to make sure that I am a complete mixed martial artist. I have trained my body, I've trained my mind, and I've put a lot of work into my soul and my spirit, and I plan on coming out and showing the world what I can do as a complete athlete, including making weight.
Mas se for pros pontos também, mas aí que eu saio com a vitória, tá tudo certo.
Valesca Machado comes bouncing into the cage, making her Invicta debut. And you can see that energy that she brings into the cage right there, Jules.
You know, she's had that energy all week, Nate. Nothing but smiles and just, I don't know, she's just happy to fight. She is happy to be here. A very, very tough young lady making her Invicta debut tonight. Interesting family history, too. She's the only one in her family who fights. She has, I think, three sisters and one brother. Yep. And she's the only one who fights from the family. And she said, you know, my mom didn't like it at first. She told me to get a real job. But now that she's seen me, she wants me to win.
She said her mom will watch MMA now, but she can't watch her daughter fight. She goes into the kitchen and then shouts at everybody to ask how the fight is going because it makes her too nervous to see what's about to happen. But you can see Machado really loves what she's doing when she's in the cage. She's a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu blue belt. She's got experience in kickboxing and boxing. She's about to make her Invicta debut.
which was the key point after missing weight two times in a row. Like I said at the top of the show, this is one of the fights that I was really interested in watching, and I'm very excited to see the aggressiveness that Liz Tracy brings.
All right, let's go to the tail of the tape presented by Verdict Tournaments. And again, take out that cell phone, scan that QR code, get all the details you need about Verdict Tournaments. Valesca Machado, 26 years old, 5'4", 63-inch reach. Liz the Titan Tracy, 34 years old, 5'3", but a slight advantage when it comes to reach in this strawweight fight. Now let's send it in to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. Three rounds, this in the strawweight division. Introducing to you first, finally out of the blue corner. She is a striker standing 5'4" tall, weighing in officially 115.75 pounds. Her professional record stands at 9 victories, 3 defeats, and 1 no contest. Finally out of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. Here is Valesca, Tina Black Machado. And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist is 5'3" tall. She weighed in at the strawweight limit, 116 pounds, and in 11 fights, holds a record of 7 victories with 4 defeats. Fighting out of Las Vegas, Nevada, here is Liz, the Titan Tracy! And your referee in charge is Kevin Nix.
Valesca Machado in her Invicta debut in the crimson and black. Liz, the Titan Tracy in the gold and black. And Liz Tracy, when we've seen her in the past, she's got an unorthodox style from times, and she has a tendency, Jules, to press the action early and often.
To press the, yes, she certainly does. And right now she's showing us some frenetic action. She's really throwing that front hand around, moving those feet, and looking for that calf kick. Valesca Machado, nice fake and feint to her right hand. Machado had a nice read on that takedown attempt.
And I think with Tracy is, she starts so far away with her exchanges, as she's constantly moving, constantly working. And so I think that could be an issue for her if she does want to take it to the ground, because she's starting her shots and her closing that range from such a big distance that it's gonna be hard for her to really solidify that position, because Machado was able to get a read on that potentially, unless she makes some adjustments.
Tied up right now. Tracy with a strong wrestling background, but Machado, like you said, that those shots from far away, that energy, that frenetic pace right before it is a nice way to disguise it, but really shooting too far on the outside in a defense. Machado kind of shucks her off after eating a slight shot.
I mean, I'm loving from Machado is she's patient. She knows that Tracy is going to come to her, so she needs to be patient, and those big shots will come.
Big right hand from Machado. Yeah, Machado just kind of looks cool and calm and collected in the center of the cage, where Tracy's a little jittery, a little, you know, amped up, and maybe that describes the body language of these two.
Oh, hey, nice read again. Good tie up there from Liz Tracy. Machado is overhooked and pushing, but Tracy's giving her a lot of pressure there. Oh, Machado spins right out. And that's the thing is, Machado, Tracy has shown us some really good footwork adjustments in past fights. But Machado can match her for the speed where it counts, it feels like.
And that's right in that striking distance.
She's not wasting any energy. She's not wasting any moment.
Tracy will switch up that stance quite often, as we saw the last fight.
Body shot there. Ooh, beautiful right.
Machado connecting with another right hand.
Don't put the head on the inside.
You know, it reminds me how Botelho told us one of the things she was going to do against Peralta was use kind of a matador technique if she bowled forward. But we can see her fellow countrywoman, Tina Black, doing that very strategy, waiting for the opportunity, spinning off and finding a shot.
We've already seen Tracy slow a little bit with that frenetic energy and that movement already, which is going to set up those shots from Machado even more so as she looks to close that range.
Big overhand right from Machado.
And you have to use fakes and feints. You have to use distracting footwork, but not too much, not so you burn yourself out and kind of give up the fact that all you're doing is feinting at times.
There's a right kick from the Titan Tracy. Under a minute to go in round number one.
Ooh, a couple of kicks from her. She saw the overhand, got out of the way this time. Beautiful uppercut.
Beautiful.
Machado catching Tracy with that right uppercut. And then
just
a left
the,
kick.
The timing. She seemed to be able to catch on to the timing of Tracy early. It's just really seems to be picking her up.
Wow. Machado knowing being tied up is now where she's had the most. She's got so much power in the end of her punches is what I'm trying to say, but she's really landing some nice elbows in there. Tracy was able to land shots in that clinch position, although it wasn't really a full clinch, it's an attempted clinch. But a lot of energy at the end of that fight.
Agreed, Julie. I just feel like Machado is just, the patience that she's displaying is having, you know, is an advantage right now. I think Tracy needs to, yeah, Machado's kind of got the timing of Tracy right now, and I think as we're seeing as this round progressed, Tracy's energy and her movement slowed, which is going to set up the timing for those big strikes from Machado even more so. I think Tracy needs to look to maybe not move as much, but close the range just slightly. If she wants to take it to the ground, she needs to not set up those shots from so far away. She's just telegraphing everything.
A feint is a move, and you have to make that move count. You have to, it's not just thrown out there, absolutely.
All right, let's check in with Eve to find out what the fans think on verdict. Ooh, look at this.
As this round started, I thought it was the unstoppable force versus the immovable object, but that unstoppable force seemed to have momentum, and that slowed down, but the fans see this one even. I see this one potentially with Machado ending this fight with an uppercut or a knee to the head.
That's a good read.
Ooh, let's see what types
kind
of adjustments get made here after round number one.
And something Tracy has shown us in the past is she can make mid-fight adjustments.
And one thing that I'm seeing is she's ducking her head off to the right when she's entering into the pocket sometimes. And like Eve said, that's if Machado makes that read, that's potential for an uppercut or a knee that could do a lot of damage.
Machado really makes her home in the center of that cage. There's also kind of the tension that we see here. Machado's very relaxed. Tracy, she said she had, it was one of her rougher camps with the weight cut, with kind of ceding control. She said she'll find her control in the fight, but she still is very tense out there.
Every time Tracy goes in with one of those kicks, there's a quick answer with a right hand from Machado.
Yeah, exactly, and she's striking right down the pipe and it's landing every time, because Tracy isn't really moving her head off the center line very much, which enables Machado to have a big giant target right there for her to land every time. And she just seems to be landing the hardest shots as well, Julie.
Absolutely.
Wow. That was big for Machado there. Right back up.
Machado showed a strong base there.
She's showcasing incredible well-roundedness right now.
And I think what's really interesting about this fight is Machado doesn't get distracted. There's a lot happening. She's not distracted. Oh, beautiful. Tracy's able to get the takedown, but having a hard time keeping Machado on the floor. Wraps her up.
She's going to get Machado's back here.
Crucifix? Looks like it. I don't think she's going to be able to maintain it, but she's on her back now. Trying to climb up, get that right hook in. Now she's sagging on Machado, dragging her to the ground. Really trying to tie up a crucifix right there. Maybe not necessarily the best place to do it or best timing to do that yet, but very creative there from Liz Tracy. I'm seeing some blood on the mat there. Do you know who's bleeding yet? Probably Liz Tracy at this point. I think she's had more hard shots to the face. But she's trying to insert that hook in there. Machado fighting hands. Looking for a Kimura there. Mm-hmm. It's a nice way of slowing down momentum. Oh, Machado spins right over it. It's a great way to set up an armbar on the far side, but I think she's content to strike right now.
A little bit of blood coming from Tracy's nose at this point.
Big welt on her forehead as well. Big jab there for Machado. Excellent job of off-centering her head as she throws those. I'd like to see if Tracy can read that and respond, but wow.
You do not want to take your eyes off this fight for a second.
Oh, no.
Now Machado's got Tracy's back. And there is the close of round number two. Tracy puts her hands up in the air, Megan, maybe feeling like she flipped the script a little bit by going in for a couple of shots.
I mean, that takedown definitely potentially won her that round, but I feel like Machado did land the more damaging and the harder punches on the feet and had a lot more success. I don't think Tracy was able to really have a lot of success in her striking. So, I don't know, it's kind of hard to judge.
Yeah, I would say Tracy definitely had some great controlling moments in the fight. She got it to places she wanted to be, but she couldn't keep it there. She couldn't, you know, finish those attempts. Machado was able to get back to her feet. Machado was actually able to reverse at the end. But I'm not saying anything judging-wise on my end at all tonight. I've already made a call that apparently judges didn't really like, so...
Well, let's find out what the fans think. They'll make some calls. Let's check in with Eve.
Well, that second round, the fans lean more towards Tracy, and I believe that's potentially from that back control exchange, but I don't feel like Tracy really controlled that position. That was still a scramble, and Machado's looking strong in this open. So let's see if Tracy can close the gap, put her on her back, and get to a finish.
There's a big right hand from Machado.
She's found that all night tonight.
But Tracy keeps coming forward.
I mean, that's just, that, she's the Titan.
Right, she's the Titan. And she presses the action, but Machado's been ready for most of it so far tonight. There's a kick to that front leg of Tracy.
No, it just feels like Machado has been able to put it all together. She's not just striking, she's not just grappling. She's able to put it all together, defensively very sound. She knows that Tracy wants to close that range and look for the takedowns. Oh, big right hand there, though.
And you can also see, look at just the posture, the stance of Machado now. There's
she's very relaxed.
She's very relaxed, but not as relaxed in the first two rounds. There's definitely more output. There's more tension in what she's doing now. She's upping her pace now. Before, she was reading and countering, landing very, very well. Now she's really trying to get some finish.
And look, you just hear the sound of those punches. Even when they miss, they sound like if they landed, they would do a lot of damage.
Liz Tracy continuing to initiate off of that drop, off of that movement. Definitely not as frenetic as before. Trying to settle herself down. I think she knows how she wants to win this fight, but it's not happening for her yet.
And I mean, when Tracy goes for those big kicks and stuff, she's not setting them up. That's why I feel like Machado was able to counter off of them so well.
Whoa, that uppercut again.
Machado. Two and a half minutes remaining.
Tracy continues to push forward. Now she's in the center of the cage. I wonder if she's going to try and keep that. Nope. Chato's like, nope, I want it.
See that blood trickling down from the nostril of Tracy with 2 minutes to go.
Ooh.
Caught it with a right hand to Tracy that time.
Kind of a clubbing right hand here.
Oh.
Man, it's just when face meets fist. You hear it through the entire arena. It's a tough jaw on Liz Tracy.
Machado looking to initiate some of the action now in round number three.
Oop, spinning back fist. Was that like the fourth one we've seen tonight?
Oh, beautiful.
Machado with another right hand. 1 minute to go.
I would not want to be hit with one of those.
That jab just stops Tracy.
Tracy's getting some of those punches in there, but it's just no visible damage on Machado. She's just not able to land that power there.
Right, and it just seems to be a power discrepancy between the two, Julie.
I just think... Oof. Oh, lovely.
Good combination from Machado.
I like the way she spun to the right on that hook and then returned back. Oh, deep in the face.
Have eaten one of those from Holly Holm before.
Oh, I have too.
Would not recommend.
No, absolutely not. Okay. Machado on Tracy's back spin elbow attempt. Machado trying to drag her down. Oh, tries to spin off on that kick. Just out of range. Nice jab there from Tracy.
Closing seconds.
She seems to be turning her body away, her head away, and her body away there.
Both sides walking off with their hands in the air. Tracy wearing the majority of the damage on her face. We will find out what the judges think of this momentarily. Valesca Machado making her Invicta debut. Cool as a cucumber in a bowl of hot sauce, as MCA once said. Meanwhile, Liz Tracy, look, she went to press the action jewels from the start in this one. She was aggressive, but she caught a lot of damage in those counters from Machado through the course of this fight. It's going to be interesting to see how the judges see this one.
Yeah, I'm not even going to call. Like I said, I wash my hands of judging. Yeah. I will say, I am insanely impressed by Valesca Machado. You know, we've seen her performance on The Contender. We've seen some of her fights from Brazil. But tonight, she was, like you said, cool as a cucumber. She didn't fall for anything. She was very determined. She got out of bad positioning on the ground, and she continued to find a home for those punches.
And like, just lovely. The power that she brought was just incredible, Julie. And there was a noticeable difference between the two when it comes to the power. And I think Tracy started off very aggressive and very frenetic with her energy and her movement. And as that slowed, Machado just knew she had to be patient. She had to be patient, wait for Tracy to slow down. And that is when she was going to be able to counter, pick her shots, and really do a lot of the damage.
Now, Tracy did move forward a lot this fight. She really did try to initiate most of the exchanges. She just didn't really finish all of the exchanges. Had some good moments on the ground. Was unable to keep Machado pinned or finish her, but definitely had some strong moments there. And she did land punches. They didn't do the same kind of damage.
Exactly.
A couple of warriors going the distance here in the strawweight division. Before we get the judge's decision, let's check in with Eve to find out what the fans thought on verdict.
Well, we look at the fan scoring of this fight. Man, the fans had a hard one with this one, going back and forth, but giving the third round to Machado. This one is a really close and tough one. Let's see how the judges have it.
And for that, let's send it up to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards, and all three see it 30-27. Your winner by unanimous decision, Valesca Tina Black Machado.
What a performance from Valesca Machado. And she just had that calm look on her face. And you can see why she had an answer for almost everything that Tracy threw at her. And Tracy threw a lot at her.
She did throw a lot at her. But Valesca Machado, undistractable. She found what she was looking for the entire fight. She found the exchanges that she wanted. And she found a home for those punches. Excellent right uppercut. We don't get to see enough right uppercuts in MMA. I'm excited to see what she does with those in the future, but really, really poised fighter, very exciting, and girl knows how to fight.
She does, and once she figured out the timing of Liz Tracy, which was very early on in the first round, the patience, the counter-striking, the power advantage that was very visible with the damage that we've seen on Tracy's face just showcased, you know, how relaxed and controlled and how comfortable she feels inside the cage. And I mean, this was a huge win for her, huge debut over an incredibly tenacious staple in Liz Tracy. And I'm very excited to see what her next fight will be.
Big performance from Machado. Now it's time for a big flyweight matchup. Ketlen Souza against Maiju Mountain Mama Suotama. Coming up next, it's tonight's co-main event, a flyweight bout pitting Maiju Mountain Mama Suotama against Ketlen Eskendadina Souza. With a late change to the card, the Finnish Suotama took this fight on short notice. Coming off three straight losses, the Mountain Mama jumped at the opportunity to get back on the winning side of things.
I feel like I'm an adventurous spirit, and actually short notice offers are somewhat usual for me.
Squaring off with Suotama tonight is Brazilian Ketlen Eskendadina Souza.
making her Invicta debut. Souza boasts an 11-3 professional record, including 8 victories by knockout. She's planning on a fast finish tonight.
Eu sou striker, gosto muito de ver sangue. Então, para os meus fãs, fãs do Invicta que ainda não me conhecem, vão ver bastante sangue em toda a minha luta.
Coming up next, it's Maiju, Mountain Mama Suotama, against Ketlen, Eskendadina Souza. One more debutante here tonight, guys, Ketlen Souza. She wanted to keep things a little close to the vest when we talked to her before this fight, maybe keep herself a little bit of a mystery as she gets ready for this big matchup tonight, and she's got to take on somebody who she only found out she'd be fighting a couple of weeks ago.
She did, and that's just showcased the type of mentality that Souza brings to the cage. She was supposed to fight for the title back in March of this year, pulled out because of issues out of her control. Then she's supposed to fight Christina Williams, Oklahoma hometown girl Christina Williams, who is an incredible athlete. Had to pull out due to injury, 2 weeks notice, now a change of opponent. She said, okay. She believes that this is her time. She feels like her opponent is too weak everywhere and she has an answer for everything. And she is ready to showcase a bloody fight tonight.
Just her second Invicta fight. And as we mentioned, she's picked this up, Jules, on just 2 weeks' notice.
Yeah, her second Invicta fight, but actually her third time in the Invicta cage as she was a part of the Invicta Phoenix Series 2 tournament. You know, Suotama, she is an interesting cat. The thing that she says about fighting is she's like, it's the payday for all of the hard work, and I haven't had a payday in a long time. She was extremely happy to take this fight. She just really wanted to get back into the cage since she's been out of action for too long, and she's faced tough competition in her day.
Yeah, it's been a year and a half since she's been in the cage in a fight. And she said that one of the things she's had to learn is to embrace the parts of it that maybe weren't so enjoyable. Embrace the struggle of training every single day, Megan. And now she finally, at long last, gets the payoff of being in a real fight.
Exactly, and it just showcases, again, her mentality of she's preparing to fight even when she's not able to get a fight. She's staying focused, she's staying ready because she knows the opportunity is going to come. The patience is important. She enjoys the days that don't always feel good. She doesn't just cherry pick the good ones, and it just showcases what an incredible martial artist we have here on our hands tonight.
Stay ready, you don't have to get ready, as we take a look at the tail of the tape in our co-main event presented by Verdict Tournaments. Scan that QR code for all the information. 28-year-old Ketlen Souza, 5'3", a 64-inch reach, and out of Finland, Maiju Suotama, 36 years old with a 66-inch reach. Now let's send it in to Joe Martinez.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we are set to go with our co-featured bout this evening. Three rounds, this in the flyweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. She's a striker standing 5 feet, 3 inches tall. Weighing in officially 123 pounds in 14 fights. Her record stands at 11 victories with 3 defeats. Fighting out of Manaus, Amazonas, Brazil. Here is Ketlen, Esquentadinha Souza. And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. A freestyle fighter standing 5 feet, 6 inches tall. She too weighed in officially 123 pounds and in 14 fights, holds a record of 8 victories with 6 defeats. Fighting out of Imatra, Finland, here is Maiju, Mountain Mama Suotama. And your referee in charge, Marcio La Selva.
Souza in the yellow and black, Suotama in the fuchsia top and the black shorts. The Mountain Mama, she said, yeah, I said fuchsia.
You gotta, is that, I am so impressed.
You tell me what color that is.
Fuchsia. I was going to say pink or salmon, hot pink. Oh, I'm very impressed right now.
Very, very tall stance for Suotama. Ketlen Souza entered this with her hands quite low.
I asked Suotama, why Mountain Mama? She said, I love that song by John Denver. As if it was a stupid question. I said, is John Denver big in Finland? She said, John Denver is big everywhere. I never knew that was a fighting song, but she said it was. Country Roads Take Me Home. It's about fighting and then going back home after the fight. And we'll see if she goes home victorious here tonight.
That was a beautiful spinoff from Souza against the cage. She grabbed the wrist, shifted, and spun completely around. Suotama still has control of the head and is reaching for that leg. Souza on the defense. Wrapping around the neck there.
Amigo, when you're preparing for one fighter through a camp and then all of a sudden 2 weeks before, it's somebody that you might not even have a scouting report on, what does that do for somebody like Souza?
I mean, honestly, for somebody like Souza, I don't think she really skipped a beat at all. If anything, it just is going to motivate her even more so to go out there, do what she wants to do, showcase her skills, and in her opinion, get the win so she can fight for the title next.
She's got 8 wins via knockout coming into this fight, does Souza.
She's extremely beautiful backspin sidekick. Flying knee attempt.
Well, this
very,
is
very relaxed.
Exactly. And I think for somebody who has an 11-3 record and has never fought out of her home country of Brazil, I'm very interested to see what she brings to the cage tonight as an with her U.S. debut.
Yeah, she's already drawn blood from Suotama. Suotama, nice timing on that shot. Beautifully done. Souza defending, but Suotama on the single leg now up against the fence. Souza made no qualms about her disdain. She said, this is a step down for me. I was supposed to fight for the title before. Then my opponent, just came off this brilliant win. Here's somebody stepping in last minute. No, she's grateful for the opportunity to fight, but she's like this, I was expecting higher competition. And you wonder, is she taking her lightly?
Well, you never want to underestimate somebody when you step in that cage, right, Jules?
No, absolutely not. I mean, it's fighting. But I do think that can't account for, the very, very relaxed approach he has. And Suotama, nice and tight in on that leg.
Suotama is very tenacious on the wrestling and looking for that takedown. But Souza's doing a really good job of framing under the face of Suotama and just creating leverage that she's not able to chain those takedowns together.
Yeah, she's leveraging with the shin and on the face, so she's doing pressure up and pressure out, and that's nice. I like it. So Thomas staying tight, though, looking for those little shots.
Beautiful short elbow on the inside by Souza there. She's digging that undercut.
Slips right under there, yeah.
Beautiful. Suotama is showing a lot of strength in this clinch position right now.
Using those braids to grind up against.
Yeah, that's a weapon out there. That hurts. Souza's got control of that wrist and actually pulling through, framing with her arm and kind of wrapped around there and then shoving her head in. Suotama staying tall, though. Tall against the cage, really kind of looking for an opportunity to shift. No. Well, I guess we're not going to have a clinch battle. Whoa!
Souza came flying in right after that separation.
She's not afraid to take risks out there.
It's not hard to see why she's got 8 knockouts to her resume.
Very explosive.
Beautiful finish of that round.
What a very emphatic ending, a stamp on the end of that round.
Well, you can see a little damage there for Suotama. Now she's tasted the power of Souza for one round. What types of adjustments is she going to have to make here going into round number two?
I mean, I feel like she needs to start, if she wants to take it to the ground, which it's clear that she's wanting to, and she's very tenacious for those takedowns, she needs to start chaining them together. Because right now, they're just stalemating, and if that's going to happen, she's not doing any damage, she's not advancing the position, the referee is just going to separate them, which gives Souza the advantage.
All right, let's check in with Eve to see what the fans think on verdict.
So that first round was pretty exciting. Souza looked very confident in that one. The fight fans have Souza up at 9.76 versus Suotama's 9.42, and I think it's from Souza's aggression and her pressure. Guys, go to verdictmma.com and let us hear your voice.
Aggression and pressure from Souza. Good way to describe what we saw from her through the first 5 minutes.
Ooh,
big overhand,
nice
right
overhand
from Souza.
Very short, sharp strikes from the Finn. Well, the Brazilian holding her hands up. Oh, kind of a spin and a miss there. Holding her hands up a little higher, but still staying very fluid, very relaxed.
Oh, beautiful sharp check hook there. I'm loving Souza's movement.
You're bouncing very, around, isn't
yes.
she?
Yes. She's never stationary. She's not a solid target for Suotama to really land anything detrimental to Souza. And she's the way that she's able to so speedily close that range is just incredible.
It's very hard to stay like in a good defense against somebody who is that fluid, who can reach that far. Beautiful timing on that shot, but Souza is able to get the underhooks, defend it, throw a knee.
Deep, deep shot too, Julie.
I love the way people have been wrapping up the hands and then hitting the liver. Very nice. And again, Suotama, she is a tough fighter, and she's fighting for little things very well. And the tightness of her frame, the way she's keeping things very kind of close and in and not overextending, she knows those flying kicks and those spins could come from any angle.
She's making the right, strategically safe decisions.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, they are not necessarily pushing the win, or I would say the points in her favor, possibly. Souza's got her nicely wrapped up there and against the cage.
And she's doing just such a phenomenal job of using that control with her forehead. I know you've talked about this for as long as I've been watching Invicta, Julie.
Use your heads, ladies. Double underhook and spin off from Souza. Suotama staying, she's sagging down with her weight a little bit, making it hard to be spun herself and really looking for an opening to kind of sit a leg in there and get over, but getting underneath that head pressure, very hard to do. Feel like I'm seeing a cage grab, but I don't have the angle, so I don't want to call it. Thought I saw some fingers in there. Good little shots in there. Oh no, don't break them up, come on. Sorry, I just love the tie-up of the hands across the body. It's creative and fun. May not be fan-friendly, though. Oof.
Oof. Oh, beautiful. Combination shot from Souza. Leg kick from Souza.
She's very creative with the way that she approaches her striking and her combinations. It's not very traditional boxing, and it's not traditional kickboxing. It's almost like she's created her own style that works for her in MMA.
Well, you're saying almost like it's almost like kind of a drunken, like monkey style in a sense that she'll look down and then
Tim Elliott.
Yeah,
it's just Tim Elliott fights.
Yeah, it's very creative. The fakes and feints. She uses all of her posture for that. Her eyes look down, you know,
like she's constantly feinting with her shoulders, feinting with her legs, swishing her stances. I mean, I've trained with Tim for a very long time.
Oh, nice body shot there. Yeah.
Yeah, she's reminiscent.
She's coming from every angle, too. I mean, it's
hard shots
it's hard
there
to
from
train
the Brazilian.
For somebody like this. Mm-hmm.
Takedown attempt from Souza.
Much less on 2 weeks' notice.
Exactly. Huh.
Now we see that framing, that steering wheel bicep control there. Love it. And still. So Thomas doing a really nice job of staying tight and, you know, a lot of those shots hit, and a lot of them she was able to get out of the way from.
Souza's just giving you so much to think about, right? The different ways and angles at which she's attacking. Body kicks, overhand shots.
She's just throwing up a lot of different offense, but she's not just headhunting. She's not just going to the head. She's not just going to the body. She's not just going to the leg. She's mixing it all and blending it all so well together. Look at that body shot right there.
That was hard.
Beautiful. And just her movement, her feints, her feinting with her shoulders. It is just the complete package, and she's showing how incredibly well-rounded she is.
A lot for Suotama to process. But there she stands with one round to go.
She
still
is
in this thing.
A while. Yeah.
Let's find out what the fans think on verdict, Eves.
Well, the fans still have Souza winning this fight convincingly. She's really putting it together well. And like you said, Megan, you know, she's being really creative. I think she's really mixing her martial arts tonight.
That's what the name of the game is, isn't it, Eve?
Lovely. Suotama's right back there trying to hit that right hand, but just out of range. And that's the thing is, if you overextend, those long Brazilian limbs can come at you, but
I think it's the rhythm. Mm-hmm. The rhythm of Souza is not your traditional boxing or kickboxing. She's striking on the offbeat. She's mixing it up, and her timing is so unorthodox because she has the striking down so pat that she knows that she can break the rhythm and create opportunities to strike in. Oof. Oh, that would definitely hurt her. Look at that elbow really staying in tight there to protect her. Oh, and another one.
And I think she's going to keep the attention down there, come up high.
Right?
That right arm is down, guarding her right side for Suotama.
Oy, spin kick. It's beautiful motion from Souza. It's almost like I keep mentioning other martial arts, but I think about capoeira from Brazil too, and just kind of the offbeat, the off angle from that, and making the fight a dance.
Souza caught her with one of those kicks to the right side in the first round, and she just has chipped away at that.
Ooh, nice shot there. Suotama. You know, and the thing is, some of those spin kicks have actually hit the elbow of Suotama, but hitting the arm when it's in that position still ricochets into the body. Like, you still feel the impact.
It's still going to force the elbow into that spot.
Oh, nice. Yes.
Oh, huge left hand there. Just her ability to strike so well from both stances, very impressive.
We've seen a lot of side kicks tonight. I am a fan for multiple fighters.
You definitely see a giant red welt on the body of Suotama. And I mean, I'd like to say Souza go back to the well.
I think she really wants that knockout. And sometimes you can't hunt it too much. You know, you have to stay on the small damage to get the big damage. But she doesn't strike me as someone who stresses much.
Oh, the amount of body shots that we have seen tonight makes me cringe on the inside. I love it.
Yeah, it makes me
to
giggle.
Watch it, but I do not
flying knee attempt
to. Oh, that's just beautiful right there.
Suotama is very, very disciplined in this.
She has
She's
been.
Not giving up very much space. She's keeping her hands together. You know, there's that right hand dropping a bit. But she's continuing to, you know, come back to her stance and look for an opportunity to attack.
Like, I feel like her hands dropping is part of her confidence. I feel like she's felt and seen everything that she's needed to see from Suotama, and I feel like that's just a sign of her confidence in her own striking and head movement and ability to get out of the way of those strikes that Suotama is throwing.
Suotama has just not really been able to initiate much of her own offense so far in this fight, though.
No, she really hasn't, Nate. And I feel like the timing and the rhythm and the unorthodox movement that Souza brings and is bringing right now, I don't think Suotama has an answer for that. I don't think she's able to really figure out the timing because there is no rhyme or rhythm behind Souza's movement. It's very capoeira-like and so hard to train for, particularly on 2 weeks' notice.
She plays a very violent game of tag, getting out of the way, smacking. Oh, nice takedown attempt.
Oh, my goodness.
That's capoeira right there. I don't even know if she has that background. It's beautiful to see martial arts on display and just the mixed martial arts, like you said.
It has been a potpourri of offense from Souza. And three rounds are complete. We'll find out what the judges think in a moment. Ketlen Souza just came at Maiju Suotama with a wide variety of offensive prowess in this, just overwhelming at times. And to her credit, Suotama adjusted. She stood there. She had the defense at times, Julie, but just never seemed to be able to get on the front foot because of that overwhelming approach of Souza.
Absolutely, but still was not put away.
Right.
Like, there were times in this fight where, you know, there was a chance. I mean, those body shots were hurting, but she was able to recover and, you know, stay disciplined enough to keep finding a way to try and attack. And I say try and attack. I know she wanted to, but she wasn't really able to launch very many successful onslaughts. Souza, on the other hand, I don't know if she's disappointed that she didn't get a knockout or a finish, but beautiful performance for her Invicta debut. Really, really, like you say, Megan, showcase of talent.
Well, Suotama had to wait for a year and a half to get this fight. She didn't know when it was going to come. She took it on 2 weeks' notice, and then she had to fight somebody that just threw everything, including the kitchen sink, at her, and she stood there.
I mean, she showed incredible toughness,
Did
mate.
She?
She yeah. didn't go away. She was always in the fight at any moment, but I think Souza just really showcased that she is incredibly high level, and what a phenomenal debut here at Invicta.
All right, let's find out what the fans thought on Verdict as we check in with Eve Edwards.
The fans kept leaning towards Souza in this one as she showed us a display of martial arts with capoeira, karate, kung fu, and everything else that you could imagine. So let's see how the judges have this one scored out.
And for that, let's go to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards, and all three have it 30-27. Your winner by unanimous decision, Ketlen Esquentadinha Souza!
Well, it was two real competitors going out there today. You can see the mutual respect once again. But Ketlen Souza, she wants a title shot, and she showed that she's going to give whoever her next opponent is a lot to think about when they break down the film of this one.
Right, well, the belt is vacant right now, and she was supposed to fight for it earlier this year, and I feel like she just showcased so much talent and high fight IQ in this fight. She had an answer for everything Suotama threw at her. Her timing, the rhythm, the movement, the creativity. She just seemed so comfortable and fluid in there, Julie, and just really put on a phenomenal display of high level athleticism and MMA ability.
Yeah, and she made it look easy.
She did.
She made it look easy. She played out there. And she was looking for a finish the entire time, and she had a tough finish to fight the entire time. But, or I should say tough fin. I almost made that joke. But seriously, she made it look fun. She made it look like play, and that's cool.
Well, we've been talking about Verdict, and of course you can weigh in on the fights tonight through Verdict, but Verdict tournaments. Scan that QR code right there if you want to get involved. It's like fantasy football action for MMA, Megan. I mean, this is some good stuff.
As our resident Australian here, I don't know much about NFL or fantasy football, but I do know about MMA, so this is right up my alley, and I'm very excited. I've seen a little bit of it on Twitter about how this works, and I am so excited. Tournament style, you can match up with anyone. I might even throw my own name in the mix, and beat some people on the internet.
Oh, man. You know, it's great. It's a really good chance to be involved as a fan and actually, you know, do things the way you think they should be done.
And there's a dollar sign at the end of it. You know what that means. It is time for the main event. The Atomweight Championship of the World on the line. Jessica the Queen Delboni and Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey.
So I think Jillian is a good fighter. She deserved this fight because the last time she made a knockout with Lindsey, and Lindsey is a contender. So for this, I think Jillian deserved this fight.
Having a knockout that I had in my last fight, I think is what every fighter dreams of. And it really felt like that. It felt like this is what everyone talks about, right? When you get asked, how do you want to finish a fight? You're like, oh, I want to knock her out, right? And to have it in that fashion, I think it just springboarded me to the next level.
I love my job. I love that I do, you know.
Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey has been at this thing for 5 years in Invicta. And it's been an up and down road. She's hung in there. And now she gets a chance at a title that, Megan, she didn't necessarily think she was ever going to get when she first started in this journey.
No, and everything has been coming into this fight. She said she was the best she's ever felt mentally, the wake up, nutrition, and she's really loving being the underdog. She thrives in the underdog mentality, and it is no case tonight that she is really digging deep into that mindset. The opportunity after 5 years of being an incredibly important staple of this division, you know, struggling to find fights, having her setbacks, the ups, the downs. You couldn't be more excited for an athlete like this that has showcased true determination, heartbreak, success, all of the emotions on display that you could ever feel in the sport of MMA. And the more times you try to knock her down, the more times she's going to get back up.
And she got a big old knockout her last time out, Jules.
She did.
Fantastic knockout. She said afterwards she wasn't even really sure that it happened. Like, she knew she had that power, and she wanted the world to see it, but she said, you know, everybody just sees I'm a grappler. They think I'm a, you know, a wrestler grappler. That's fine. And then she was able to shock the world. And like Megan said in the intro, she wants lightning to strike twice.
She does.
The challenger, Jillian Jillybean. The Lionheart DeCoursey. Her crown, Jéssica, the Queen Delboni. And Jules, she had to work her way back into that rematch to get this title. So it meant a lot to her. You saw it when she won that fight against Zapatella. Now she has to defend that belt.
Yeah, she has also not had an easy road into this position, and it's her fortitude and her mindset. But she also, after the split decision loss to Zapatella, she was ready to quit. She was just like, I just don't, it's not giving me, MMA's not giving me. Shannon Knapp convinced her to enter the Phoenix tournament. Less than a month later, she comes back out, does it, wins the whole thing, and then wins the rematch against Zapatella. And she said, I was always the champion. Now it's solidified. But I don't know about that adage that says you're not really the champion until you defend the belt, but I think that's the lore, people say, and I think it does really cement that you are a champion when you don't let somebody take it away from you. And that's exactly what Jillian DeCoursey has to do, according to Delboni. She said, yeah, she's tough, she's great, she's a good fighter, but she has to come and take this belt.
She knows about the knockout that Jillian DeCoursey delivered her last time out, but doesn't necessarily think that that makes Jillian DeCoursey a knockout type fighter.
Yeah, I mean, you cut hair once, does that make you a barber? No, but every fight is different, and stylistically, this is a very different matchup to, you know, both of their last opponents. She's prepared to continue her legacy. She's not nervous with this fight. She's very relaxed. And she feels like her cardio is going to be the most important thing for her tonight. And when we spoke to the champion coming into this fight, she said she feels like everybody knows what she likes to do. She doesn't really stray from her style. However, when they get inside the cage with her, it's a very different story, and no one has seemed to be able to really capitalize on anything that she brings. It brings a different style, the aggression, the patience, the counter-striking. She doesn't feel like anyone is prepared for what she's going to bring inside the cage.
Mm-hmm. Alicia Zapatella, the former champ, knows a little thing or two about both of these fighters. Nice to have Alicia tuning in to watch this one. And I agree, I think we all do. This is gonna be fun. Let's go to the tail of the tape. And once again, we're presented by Verdict Tournaments. Scan that QR code, get all your details. 38-year-old Jilly Bean, Lionheart DeCoursey, 63-inch reach. Jessica the Queen Delboni, 29 years old, a 62-inch reach as she defends her Atomweight title here tonight. Now let's send it into Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, here we go. Live around the world from Sugar Creek Casino here in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. This is the main event. Five rounds scheduled this for the Invicta FC Atomweight Championship of the World. And it's sanctioned by the Citizen Potawatomi Athletic Commission. Executive Director is Diana Fletcher. The Commissioner, Mr. Joey Miller. The three judges scoring at cage side for this contest, Sarah Atwood, Mike Bauer, and Liz Carrero. And when the action begins inside the cage, your referee in charge, Kevin Nix. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the judges are ready, and the fighters are ready. Oklahoma, make some noise if you are ready! Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, a Brazilian jiu-jitsu practitioner standing 5 feet, 2 inches tall. She weighed officially 104 and 3/4 pounds and in 8 fights, holds a professional record of 5 victories with 3 defeats. Fighting out of Long Island, New York, here is the challenger, Jilly Bean, Lionheart DeCoursey! And across the cage stands her opponent, fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist is 5 feet, 1 inch tall. She too weighed officially 104 and 3/4 pounds, and in 15 fights holds a record of 12 victories with 3 defeats. Fighting out of Niterói, Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. She is the reigning, defending, Invicta FC Atomweight Champion of the World, Jessica, the Queen Delboni!
Okay, fighters, we went over the rules in the back. I expect a good, clean fight with no fouls. Touch gloves if you want to now. Go to your corner, be warriors.
A smile from Lionheart DeCoursey, a scowl from the Queen Delboni, and the Atomweight Championship of the World is on the line tonight from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. And away we go. Delboni in all yellow. DeCoursey in the black and yellow. Five years in Invicta of work for DeCoursey, ups and downs. At long last, she stands here with a chance to take the belt. Delboni worked so hard to get that title away from Zapatella. She has it now. She does not want to let it go.
Definitely a measuring out process between these two fighters at the start of this. A lot of fakes and feints. No real commitment yet. Both of them just absolutely charming human beings in their own way. Like,
oh, for sure.
So relaxed and great to talk to each of them in their fight weeks. Delboni recently got married. She's having quite a year getting a title and a husband.
DeCoursey grew up playing street basketball in Harlem with the boys and said that that was when she developed the mindset of looking to prove everybody around her wrong.
Yeah, she went to college to play basketball, which I was like, I'm sorry, what position did you play? Are you in the same height requirements for college basketball, but she did phenomenally well.
You can see the quickness out there right now.
She's got very long arms, too. You know, DeCoursey is just kind of one of those people that's just such a benefit to the MMA community in general. Huge advocate for mental health in the community. Won't let people trash talk her opponents online, just refuses to accept it. It's kind of old school level of respect.
Well, Invicta's about empowerment, right?
Yeah, it absolutely is.
That's what this is about.
But, you know, there's different levels of it. They still try to knock each other out. But, you know, but the empowerment doesn't... Ooh, nice. Delboni is so quick.
Of course, he coming off that devastating knockout against Lindsey VanZandt her last time around. But even she does not describe herself as a knockout artist. She says, I'm a grinding fighter, typically. She said, my face looks beat up at the end of a fight more than the opponent.
Well, she said she was very concerned going back to training because she was so scared to hurt her training partners after that fight. She didn't realize that that type of power was in her, but with a lot of the changes that she's made over the last year or so, we're really seeing a Jillian DeCoursey 2.0 that's showcasing she's not just a wrestler and a striker.
Absolutely.
She's got striking and she's very good at what she does, and she's becoming a well-rounded athlete.
Mm-hmm. Nice knee there, but she lost her balance a bit on that back leg, and Delboni took advantage of that.
Delboni's already reddened up that front standing leg.
Oh, nice knee there again. Yeah, Delboni makes such quick adjustments. Like, she's just really able to read angles and get in there.
Well, I mean, there is a lot of experience on Delboni's side. She's got 15 professional fights as opposed to DeCoursey's 8. I mean, DeCoursey did have an extensive 9-fight amateur career, but I mean, those professional fights, those 5-round fights definitely make a difference when it comes to experience.
Absolutely. You can see Delboni was in on that single, switches up, and gets DeCoursey around. DeCoursey on top, though!
What a
DeCoursey on top in the mount. Delboni
now she's
rolls
got
over. She's got the back. DeCoursey. Now, Delboni has shown us some really great awareness, but she is trying to get under the neck. I cannot see from this angle.
Both of them brown belts in jiu-jitsu. This is going to be interesting to see. Oh, she's underneath
the neck now. Oh, my goodness. Look at that. DeCoursey brought in Fatima Klein and Erin Blanchfield to help her with this camp. Really
both,
wanted to
both of them.
Oh, wow, that's
oh
tight.
My goodness.
Holy crap.
She's got the game
she's
grip, which is going to be really hard.
Squeezing her hand, really extending the ball. Oh, Lionheart is the new Atomweight champion of the world.
A submission in the first round from Chili
Beans.
Lionheart, DeCoursey to take the belt in stunning fashion.
Goodness, wow.
She made her debut in this organization, her pro debut, and now she is the organization's champion. My God, what a fairy tale.
The queen has lost her crown to Lionheart DeCoursey. Second fight in a row for DeCoursey that stops in the first round, but in very different fashion this time. Amazing jiu-jitsu from DeCoursey this time around.
Jillian DeCoursey 2.0 is here, and she is showcasing why she is the champion, and she is on top.
Amazing. She had this confidence in herself the entire time.
What
it's just amazing to see
moment.
It happen.
5 years later, she is fighting for the title for the first time, and she certainly delivered.
We had 7 fights tonight, ladies. The first 6 went the distance.
Right.
The championship fight ends in the first round with seconds remaining, by the way. We were down to about 10 seconds left to close out the first round. And the queen was just not able to hold her off long enough, and she had to tap.
Lightning does strike twice for Jillian DeCoursey. What an incredible moment.
DeCoursey, the new Atomweight champion of the world. You can just see the look on Jillian DeCoursey's face, what it means. She worked to earn that title shot. She got it, and she's the new champ. Let's send it in to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, the rear naked choke submission comes officially at 4 minutes, 49 seconds of round number one. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the end comes officially. 4 minutes, 49 seconds, round number one. Submission by rear naked choke for your winner. And now the new Invicta FC Atomweight champion of the world, Jimmy Bain, Lionheart DeCoursey!
You just never know what you're going to see when you come to one of these Invicta events. And Jillian DeCoursey put on a show here tonight, and she is standing by with Ali Trost Martin.
Jillian, congratulations. You told us that early on in your career, you thought the chance to fight for this belt would be impossible. Here you are with it around your waist. How would you put this achievement into words?
I would say never doubt yourself. Never let anyone doubt you. If you put a goal in mind and you work hard enough, anything is possible. And I definitely proved that tonight.
And you do it with a first round submission. I think everyone in this room wants to know what was going through your mind as you finish this one off.
I saw her turn. Rear naked chokes are one of my best moves lately. I felt it lock in, and I heard my coaches counting down the time. And they're like, just be patient, keep squeezing, you're almost there. And I was like, all right, that's it. I don't want to go into the second round. We're finishing this.
What's next now that you are the champion?
Well, first, I'm going to take a much-needed mini vacation. We're going to Vegas tomorrow, kind of celebrate a little bit. Then right back to training and looking for my first defense.
Is there anyone that you have any message that you want to share that's watching out there tonight?
Absolutely. I went into this fight a huge underdog. I was doubted. I was trash talked online. People were telling me I didn't belong. And, you know, this is for not just for me to prove to myself, but for anyone that's ever been doubted, anyone that's ever been told something's impossible. You know, I'm 38 years old, and I just captured the Invicta Atomweight Championship belt. So anything you want to do, you can do.
What an inspiring message. Let's watch that one more time. Take a look up at the screens. Jillian, can you walk us through this?
Jessica had me up against the cage. She was strong, but the clinch is my favorite place. I knew once she went and took me down, I have that nice little butterfly sweep, and it was just, I was in my comfort zone from that moment on, and it just all flowed through.
Well, we could see what this meant to you in your reaction. Congratulations again on this achievement. The belt is yours. Let's hear one more time for our champion, Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey.
Okay, excuse me. Jillian, congratulations for your job.
Thank you.
Congratulations, I respect you. So, I will ask you, let's go to fight again, please. I know you want to relax like me, because I know I fought for the belt too. I want to relax you, but let's do one more fight. And I hope you accept, because I have a big history with, you know, you are a veteran too. So I hope you accept my challenge, please. Thank you.
Yeah, let's see what Shannon says, and we'll go from there. But I respect you so much. I knew coming into this fight you were going to be a tough fight, and I knew I had to, you know, put 110% to even have a chance. So thank you.
Thank you.
The street baller from the Queens, New York. She's been out to prove people wrong ever since she was doing that as a kid, and she did it in the cage here tonight, Jules.
I'm not crying, you're crying. I mean, what a story. Like, two terrific human beings, but what a story, what a finish.
Everything has certainly come full circle for Jillian DeCoursey, and she did not let this opportunity go to waste.
And one final thought from Eve Edwards.
Man, the ladies really put it on tonight, but that finish, I'm speechless. I'm speechless, but I'm happy for Jillian DeCoursey.
And we're happy that you had a chance to watch this all with us. It was an incredible night here tonight. For Ali Trost Martin, Eve Edwards, Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson, this is Nate Buchanan saying thanks for watching Invicta FC 49.